Hiya. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People in 2024. How symmetrical. We have apologies from Stephanie Callaghan and Ross Greer, so I'd like to welcome Jackie Dunbar and Gillian Mackay, who are both substitute members joining us today. And as is the first time that both Jackie and Gillian have attended our committee, our first item of business is to invite both members to declare any relevant interest. So, in no particular order, Jackie?
Thank you, convener, and thank you for the welcome. I have no interest to declare.
Thank you. Gillian?
Thanks, convener, and thanks for having me. No relevant interest to declare. Thank you.
Oh, that makes it easy. Thank you very much. So, our next item on our agenda is consideration of a petition, PE1747, which was about adequate funding to support children with additional support needs in all Scottish schools. And the committee had previously agreed to consider the issues raised in the petition as part of our work programme. And during a subsequent discussion, the committee agreed to undertake an inquiry into additional support for learning. And we published our inquiry report in May this year. The Scottish Government responded to that report in July, and the committee will be holding a debate on the very subject this afternoon, and on the report and the recommendations. So do any members have any comments further to make about this petition? No. And given the work that the committee has already undertaken in this area, are we, has the committee agreed to close this petition? Yeah. Thank you very much, members. That's super. Okay, so the next item on our agenda is an evidence session for stage one of the Education Scotland Bill. And today we're going to hear from two panels of witnesses. Firstly, can I welcome our first panel, Gillian Hamilton, Chief Executive of Education Scotland, Janie McManus, sorry, I'm having a bit of a moment there. Janie McManus, His Majesty's Chief Inspector of Education for Scotland, Education Scotland, and Fiona Robertson, Chief Executive of the Scottish Qualifications Authority, SQA. Good morning, ladies. We've got a lot to get through this morning, so we're going to move straight to questions from members. And firstly, can I bring in Liam Kerr, please?
Yes, good morning. Good morning, panel. Fiona Robertson, I'll direct a question straight to you. There have been concerns raised about the same actors pre- and post-reform being in the old and the new bodies. Now, several reports highlighted that there were various fundamental issues with the SQA and requiring reform. Do you and presumably the management of the SQA accept all of those characterisations and issues in their entirety, or are there any which in your view went too far or were unfair?
Well, first of all, good morning, and thank you for inviting us to appear before the committee today. Very happy to speak about the bill and issues in relation to reform, including the replacement of SQA and the establishment of Qualifications Scotland. Obviously, have read the responses to the committee's consultation on the bill, and very happy to talk about the bill itself. And I think SQA has put on record our support for the legislation, in particular the proposals to ensure learners and educators are at the heart of decision-making in Qualifications Scotland. And I think that builds on the recent actions that we've taken to strengthen learner and educator engagement. However, we've also made clear that the bill is a catalyst for far more reaching and fundamental reform. And if change doesn't start and stop with the provisions in the bill, and if it were to do so, I think a major opportunity would be lost. So our forthcoming prospectus for change sets out an ambitious agenda for the transformation of SQA into Qualifications Scotland. And there are three key pledges there. One is around resetting relationships with learners and educators to win back their trust. Secondly, grasping the potential of technology to streamline the services that we offer. And thirdly, delivering qualifications and assessments that keep pace with rapid changes in society and which supports the government's response to the Hayward Review. And of course, it also, you mentioned staff, is it important that we include a commitment to staff?
Can I just see through the changes forgive me ahead. Cutting across you, Fiona Robertson, but I'm sure these issues will come out during this session. What I asked was whether the SQA specifically accepts the criticisms in their entirety that were levelled.
I respect the views that have been provided to the committee and the views that have been provided across a range of reviews in Scottish education.
May I ask, we all respect the views, but that suggests to me, or I put it to you, that suggests you disagree with some of the criticisms.
It doesn't suggest I disagree. I think I highlighted that I respected the views, and we seek views and we engage with teachers, we engage with learners, and we are seeing the fruits of that engagement. But I think the feedback that you received, that the committee received on the bill, highlighted that the bill in and of itself does not go far enough. That the bill provides the scaffolding for further change, and that's what I'm seeking to set out to you today.
I will ask you a direct question about that in just 2 seconds, so I'll hold you there if you don't mind. But how much involvement did you and the SQA then have in drafting this bill such that it's something that the SQA's worked, given the criticisms that were made? You will have the knowledge. Have you had input into this bill, or is it rather being drafted and imposed from the government?
I think we, alongside a range of stakeholders across Scottish education, have had the opportunity to provide advice both formally and informally to the Scottish Government in relation to the provisions in the bill. But the drafting of the bill is obviously undertaken by the Scottish Government. But I'm supportive of the provisions in the bill in relation to learner and educator engagement. And as I say, I think it builds on what more formally provides a scaffolding for further work in this area.
Let me ask you directly about that, if you don't mind, then. So you're supportive of the learner provisions. Does that then suggest that there are provisions that you're not supportive of? And as part of answering that, do you think that this bill addresses all of the criticisms that were levelled at the SQA, and is there anything missing or requiring of amendment?
I think the SQA's position, as provided to the committee, is that it's supportive of the bill. I think, and I've obviously listened to the evidence that was provided last week. I think while the policy memoranda does not highlight issues with respect to the division of responsibility around accreditation, regulation and awarding, that is something that has come. I think that is something that is coming through both in the responses to the committee from stakeholders and also came through at that last week's session.
Very grateful.
Thank you. Willie Rennie?
I apologise for the direct nature of this question, but it's what other people are asking, so I hope you don't mind me asking it to you, Fiona. Should the leadership of the SQA become the leadership of Qualification Scotland?
Well, ultimately, that is not a matter for me to determine. However, I think there are a couple of points that I think it might be important and appropriate for me to make. And I understand the question that you're asking. Obviously, it's a question that requires a degree of sensitivity, because while I am chief executive of the SQA, I also have a leadership team and a wider organisation behind me, and they work hard to deliver. So, two things. One is in relation to the commitment that the Scottish Government made to the employees of SQA at the point at which, almost 3.5 years ago, at the point at which the announcement was made to replace the SQA, which was that all staff would have the right of transfer to Qualification Scotland. And I think there are provisions in the bill to that effect. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that, and I think it's on record in response to a parliamentary question from Pam Duncan-Glancy, that the chair of the SQA has been commissioned to look at certain aspects of the establishment of Qualification Scotland, and that includes the establishment of a schools unit, a consideration of a head teacher coming into the organisation, and that was mentioned in the Cabinet Secretary's statement in relation to Hayward last week, and looking at the leadership structures. So I think it's important that the committee is aware of the commitments that the Scottish Government has made in relation to all staff in SQA, in relation to the establishment of Qualification Scotland, and also the commission that has been that has been made of the chair in relation to some of these issues. But my focus and the focus of my team at the present time and always is to continue to deliver qualifications and award qualifications to learners across Scotland. And it's really important that I say that. That is my priority and that is my focus.
I suppose there is a difference between having the right to remain in post and exercising leadership and making the decision that because of the groundswell of demand for change, that whether you should remain in that post. So there's a difference between the two, but I won't ask you to go any further than that. I just want it to be put onto the record that there is a whole range of organisations that have expressed very strong views, many local authority education officers and heads of education like West and Bartonshire say a wholesale transfer of personnel to Qualification Scotland would undermine the reform process. Inverclyde say the same people will still be involved, leading to the same approach by another name. Moray Council, how will the current system be different if the same people are leading in senior roles? And there's lots of other organisations like that. I mean, how do you view those responses? Does that affect the decisions that you and your team, that you think you'll make going forward?
Well, I understand the points that have been made, not least in the context of a bill which obviously creates a new organisation that has the same functions, not just in broad terms, in quite specific terms, as the existing organisation. So therefore, I understand why a number of stakeholders and a number of responses to the committee's consultation on the bill highlight the need for change. But what we've been seeking to do in response to some of the concerns that have been raised about the SQA is to engage, and that has included engagement with some members of the committee, including yourself, Mr. Rennie, in relation to our corporate plan, which we are setting out as a perspective for change, which highlights that the bill is the scaffolding for further change to the new organisation. And therefore, the focus is, in addition to ensuring that we continue to deliver through this time. And we talked last year, I think, about the uncertainty and the impact that uncertainty has had on all of my colleagues in SQA, whilst at the same time seeking to ensure that there's a successful transition to Qualification Scotland. And there are some quite significant elements around that transition, but also that we can continue to build and we can continue to build on some of the issues that have been raised. And I highlighted that I do feel that we have taken steps to address those issues, and indeed our engagement I think is showing we're seeing the fruits of our labour there in relation to the feedback that we're getting from educators and learners through some of our survey work, and that involves hundreds of learners and stakeholders. But I understand and respect what people have said. I think my job and the job of the team behind me is to make sure that we're working hard consistent with our statutory duties, which can be quite challenging to win their trust and to continue to deliver. Thank you.
Just so the panel know, we have the questions are going to come in blocks. So I've got a section here focused predominantly on the SQA. So if it does feel like a little intense for yourself at the moment, we will be moving on to the other parts. It's just to. So I want to ask a little bit, and I want to say thank you very much, Fiona Robertson, for your letter that you sent and we circulated around the committee members yesterday. But I want to ask about what progress has been made in rebuilding the confidence of the teaching profession and the SQA, because Professor Muir commented that it was evident to me in my engagements that there are significant relationship issues within the current SQA. And if we think about the reputation and the trust, there's been some quite high-profile events that took place around the results this coming year, from empty emails to history marking, which... So I'm just wondering if you want to comment on that and how might the provisions in the bill either prevent that or strengthen the trust and relationships with learners and teachers going forward. Thank you.
So there's a number of things there. I will try and be brief, but if
yes,
if,
that'd be lovely.
If there are issues that you want me to elaborate on, mm-hmm. please let me know. I think in response to the previous question, I set out some of the things that we've been doing around that broader consultation and engagement with the system, and considering those issues as we develop our perspectives for change, and I've set some of that out, and that includes, you know, how we consult with schools, colleges, training providers, how we engage with teachers. And also learners, and just a couple of weeks ago I met with our learner panel just to talk about some of the issues that were on their minds, but also visiting schools and other education.
What were some of the issues that were on those learners' minds then that you seek?
I think learners are on the basis of successive discussions with learners. I think the consistent feedback that we've had...
No, it's not. I'm sorry, not what you think. Sorry. What was the feedback that they gave you at that panel? Okay. Yes, sorry. Yeah.
No, I think that's what I was... what I was trying to say. I think my observation on the basis of the feedback that we had is that I think learners are really keen for us to explain the decisions that we take. Uh-huh. And I think they recognise that it's not always possible to reach agreement on every issue, but it's important to provide feedback and to demonstrate that we've listened and we've reflected, and we've made decisions on the basis of a balance of evidence, and that's what we've been seeking to do through, for example, our evaluations each year on awarding and other things. So there's been some consistent feedback in relation to that. We've sought to do more of that.
In terms of some of the criticisms regarding the emails and
yes.
that sort of, is there anything you can, in terms of restoring the trust and confidence of the people that may be tuning in to listen to this morning, to give them some information around that?
So in relation to the email issue on results day, obviously that was regrettable. I apologise for that. All 145,000 learners get paper certificates, and those are posted, and members will be well aware of that. A minority of learners will sign up to get the results from 8 o'clock in the morning of results day, either by email or text or both. A small minority, around 5% of learners, opt to get email only. Mm-hmm. So around 7,500 learners. And unfortunately, on results day, blank emails were sent out at 8 o'clock.
Was that to the people that only email only?
Email only.
So they did,
although it's important to highlight that all get paper certificates. Uh-huh, so that wasn't impacted. So blank emails were sent out at 8 o'clock. I was informed of that shortly thereafter. And by 9:15, the issue was resolved and the correct emails were sent. We undertook a review in mm-hmm. relation to what happened. Of course, I think the priority on results day was obviously resolving the problem and putting it right, and that's what we sought to do first thing in the morning. It was an issue of human error that effectively there's a merge mm-hmm. system between a shell email, mm-hmm. which is what was sent, and the importing of individualised results to that shell email. So there was a human error in relation to that. We have a lot of manual processes and systems in SQA, and you know that's why one of our planks of our prospectus for change is transforming our technology, because with ageing infrastructure, there are risks, mm-hmm. and unfortunately, and it is with great regret, we saw how that played out on results day, but it was fixed really quickly.
Yeah, okay.
So that's the issue in relation to the email issue.
Do you think the provisions in the bill are going to strengthen and rebuild the confidence of the with teachers and learners and parents and carers? Do you think there's an opportunity to do that?
I think what I said to Mr. Kerr is in relation to the bill specifically. The bill provides the scaffolding. And it includes some important provisions in relation to governance, mm-hmm. in particular learner and practitioner committees, in particular in relation to learner and practitioner charters and other matters. But it is, I think, legislation by definition provides scaffolding. I think what I'm saying is that there will be important issues in relation to how we take forward these issues and how we take
That's
forward
great. I know on some of those themes there it leads nicely to the questions from John Mason
okay.
now.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, convener. Yes, absolutely, that was the area I was going to go into because I will be interested in Education Scotland's view on this as well, not just SQA or Qualification Scotland. But yes, one of the proposals in the bill is for, as you've just mentioned, these charters.
Yes.
And the interest committees, and also I think the Strategic Advisory
yes.
Council.
Yes.
So these are all either new or revised bodies.
Indeed.
Although I think there already is an advisory council,
if
I'm not mistaken.
There is an advisory council, a long-established advisory council.
So how do you see how will this change how things work, having these different organisations or groups?
There is a lot of learner and practitioner engagement at the moment, but I think the establishment of the committees provides a formal and obviously a legislative underpinning to some of those structures, and I think there is both symbolism and a practical aspect to that in terms of being able to establish formally and underpinned by statute the contribution and importance of ensuring that learners and practitioners are at the heart of Qualification Scotland, and I think that will be an important demonstration and as I say underpinned by legislation.
And are they not at the heart of things at the moment?
I think what I'm saying is it provides a legislative underpinning to that. I can talk further if you wish around the work that we do at present in relation to these issues. So the establishment, for example, of the learner panel, the work as you've highlighted, the advisory council, which is long established. The work that I instituted around the National Qualifications Strategic Group, which at points during the pandemic was meeting on a weekly basis, we're bringing together all the stakeholders, including learner representatives, to consider issues around certification during and post-pandemic, and indeed the first meeting of the National Qualifications 25 Group will be this Friday. So that there are a number of mechanisms that we've used to strengthen and deepen learner and practitioner engagement, But I think what the bill does is provide that legislative underpinning. And that ultimately was a decision that government took, but it's one that the SQA has supported.
So the fact that the interest committees exist will be in legislation.
Yes.
But that will not automatically mean that the rest of Qualification Scotland, be that the board or anyone else, will necessarily take more into account than has happened in the past. I mean, that's more of a kind of cultural and attitude thing, isn't it? An ethos thing?
Yeah, I mean, I think I've already set out that the bill provides the scaffolding for that. And, you know, we've also made clear that the bill is a catalyst for further change. And what we're seeking to do through our prospectus for change is to set out those core areas where we think we can go further and deeper around that engagement. And in particular, SQA works with thousands of teachers every year. We have thousands of markers. We engage extensively and do events, for example, on understanding standards, course materials, etc. But I think it will also be important to ensure that we're reaching practitioners who perhaps are not marking for us, but who perhaps have no other formal engagement with us. And I think through our second plank around transforming our technology, there are opportunities to do that to ensure that we are giving all learners and all educators the opportunity to engage with us should they wish to. And I think that will be an important part of the offer that will underpin the new body.
And does the present advisory council, does it have a lot of input? I mean, could you give us any example of where it's suggested something or commented and that's made a difference?
Yeah, I mean, the advisory council over a period of time has provided advice on, for example, the approach to certification, approach to appeals, other things, a whole range of things, and a report, well, issues to the board in relation to the advice that the advisory council has provided. So the advisory council, alongside other committees that the SQA has, including the qualifications committee, which is meeting today, will also provide advice, including on some of those more technical aspects. There are also national qualifications subject teams, which are groups of teachers that are providing, again, perhaps more technical advice in relation to individual subjects and individual courses. So there's quite a lot going on, mm-hmm. and there has been quite a lot going on. I guess your question is in relation to the provisions in the bill, which I think go one step forward, one step further in terms of that legislative underpinning.
Yes, I mean, I think the committee as a whole accepts that there's quite a lot going on, and that therefore the question is, well, what difference is the bill going to make,
yes.
and what more will happen, or what different things will happen? Mm-hmm. If I could just ask you one other point, I think just now.
Come in as well.
Right, can I ask this?
Yeah, and then, go for it, John.
So the EIS, I think it was, questioned, you know, how the Strategic Advisory Council and these interest committees will interact with each other?
Yeah.
Does one trump the other, or how does that work, do you think?
Well, I do think there will be... the bill has obviously just been introduced. I think there will be further work to do as part of the implementation of the legislation to consider these issues in more detail. But I think the broad point is that we'll be looking at feedback in the round. Obviously, there'll be some formality around each of these groups. But it will be important that that each of these committees is able to fulfil their functions and provide a formal input to the decisions that are being made. Decisions that are made by Qualification Scotland.
Okay, I don't know if Education Scotland have any thoughts on this.
Gillian has got quite a bit. She's been trying to get in for a while. And oh, apologies, I meant Gillian Hamilton.
My apologies.
Good morning. And it's just really to pick up on that point when you spoke earlier and said you would be interested in an Education Scotland view. Janie may also have a view around the engagement through the inspectorate. But I would agree with Fiona around the fact that structures and scaffolding take us so far. So your question around the content of the legislation, that does provide, I'm going to re-quote Fiona, that kind of formal and legislative structure. But the feedback from the reviews that have taken place over the last number of years are really loud in the importance of not just the views of stakeholders, but in the ways of working across the teaching profession. And we probably will pick this up later in the discussion, but there's no legislation required for a refocused Education Scotland, and that absolutely does not mean that a refocused Education Scotland should not have the sound structures, scaffolding and governance in place. But I want to pick up on a point that Mark Priestley made, I think, just last week around the beyond representation. So I think Mark talked about examples of practice where we have really strong representation from key stakeholders across the Scottish education landscape. But it's a step beyond that, I think, and Fiona touched on this, for the refocused and the established organisations. It has to be about the cultural ways of working and about how the profession really not just see that they can be engaged, but feel an engagement. And we've been taking forward some work that I won't talk about just now.
Do you think that's is that part of the problem at the moment, that people maybe are engaged a bit, but they just don't feel it?
Or I think sometimes they're not engaged. They hear about engagement that has taken place. So one specific example of that is the curriculum improvement cycle work that is underway. So we have almost 1,000 teachers who've engaged with Education Scotland in that process during the pilot reviews and into the first stage of the improvement cycle. But we have over 51,000 registered teachers in Scotland. Now, 1,000 teachers engaging is a big improvement, perhaps, in previous engagements, but there's still a way to go. So some teachers will see engagement is taking place, but they won't feel that they've been part of that. And we can't, I don't think we can do that one by one with every teacher, but we can work in partnership with COSLA, with the Association of Directors of Education, to really corral the teaching workforce to be a much greater part of those ways of working. Thank you.
Did Ms McManus want to come in?
Just to echo the points, I think it's really important that for any national body that we're really open to hearing diverse views, whether it's stakeholders and particularly learners, young people, adult learners, because that's who we're sort of working for and delivering for. And I think in legislation, I suppose it sort of underpins the importance of that by setting some things in legislation around the commitment to engaging much more with stakeholders, the engagement of hearing different voices in the system. But like others have said, that's, I suppose, the first step and the foundation of it. The next step is about how exactly it's taken forward. And I think we also need to be really important that any formal mechanism, whether it's a council or a forum, that can't be the only way of getting views. And there's an element that I would say about getting views and diverse views engaging before things happen or before new developments take place. But there's also how do you get views from people and that people are really engaged with during work and during activities. So from my perspective, when we're carrying out inspection activity, how do we make sure that people feel engaged during that? And then afterwards, after something's been taken forward, how are we getting, I suppose it's the feedback loop. How did it feel for you? Did it deliver? Did it have an impact? So that we can all learn and do things differently. So it's a starting point, but I suppose a bit element next is how it's taken forward and what mechanisms that we put into place to make sure it's having the desired impact, not just for the organisations, but for stakeholders and learners as well.
Okay, thanks so much.
George Adam, you've been waiting very patiently. Thank you.
Thank you. And it's never normally said about me being patient, convener, so that's a nice wee change. Good morning, everyone. I'd just like to... Actually, it was originally just going to be for Fiona, but I think you can all chip in, should you wish. But transferring staff over from when there's organisational change in its entirety isn't unusual. You know, it's a kind of... best way to work, 9 times out of 10. But there are specific challenges with SQA, as some of my colleagues have already brought up earlier on as well. And Fiona, you spoke about the bills, the scaffolding. But when the scaffolding's built, you need to actually deliver and actually get the job done. So we heard last week from various individuals that came in and said that the educational landscape is challenging, it's very busy, there's a lot of people there. So how do you feel with this change? Are you going to be able to, all the organisations, to work together to ensure that you can deliver this time? Scaffolding's built, it's time to do the job. How do you do that?
Well, I think our collective priority is always to do the job, isn't it? I mean, and actually, I note the comments that were made around, for example, the email issue on results day, but the fact is we delivered results to 145,000 learners on results day, you know, marked over a million scripts in a period of 14 weeks, have been working through appeals, and at the same time preparing the ground for next year's exam diet, and the timetable for next year's exam diet has just been published. So the priority is always to deliver. But in addition, over the last few years, obviously there's been quite a lot of uncertainty in relation to the future of our organisations, and certainly my organisation. And so therefore, we have also needed to ensure that we support staff as much as possible, that we think about those elements and start to plan for those elements of transition, which is about moving, you know, which is about the transition from SQA to Qualifications Scotland. At the same time, also think about, as you say, as you, using the scaffolding analogy, actually starting to, you know, begin to build and meet the aspirations and consider the feedback that we've had. There's been a lot of reviews in Scottish education in recent years. In addition to that, let's not lose sight of what it is that we do, which is qualifications. And of course, we've just had the Scottish Government's response to the report that Louise Hayward published in May 2023. So there's a programme of work there. So my job and the job of the organisation at the moment is to make sure that we are focusing as far as possible in all those things in the right way, so that we can continue to deliver for Scotland's learners. And I would highlight that given all those things I've just said, and given the feedback and given the challenges within Scottish education at the present time, that makes it quite a tough job for us all, I think, at the present time. But our commitment and our focus remains on doing that in the best way possible. And I think it's really important that I say that to the committee this morning, not least in the context of some of the feedback that you've received. So that's the priority. And if that means, using the analogy, you know, absolutely building brick by brick, that is what we will do.
Janie or Gillian?
No, I think just echo it. It's been a huge period of uncertainty for staff in all the organisations as they're going through change, looking for sort of stand-up dates of new organisations. And while, you know, the guarantee for staff moving, you know, for staff moving into the inspectorate, and it will be housed by the Privy Council status will remain for inspectors. It has been a huge period of change. And going along with the change and the transition plan that we need to put in place to get us, I suppose, to that day one of a new body, it's continuing to deliver our inspection services for children and young people and adult learners in Scotland at the same time as we're trying to take that work forward and that transition. And all credit to our staff for continuing to do that work as well. And then coupled with that is the, what do we have to do just now to change some of the elements of our inspection work that we can do without legislation. So we're trying to make those changes and improve things, listening to feedback, put new mechanisms in place at the same time as delivering our existing work and preparing for that new that transition into being a new body as well.
Thank you. Gillian?
And I won't repeat the points that my colleagues have already made, but to add to those, when I took up post as interim chief executive, I set three priorities for myself to lead the organisation through reform. And Fiona and Jenny have both recognised already the hard work of our staff during a real period of uncertainty to move towards new ways of working. So not to wait until a stand-up date, as Jenny said, but to start making the changes now and to enhance stakeholder relationships. And again, we might come back to that. Because you asked about the role of the organisations in this space, and there has been a focus on structural reform and new and refocused organisations. And that's part of the reform jigsaw. But if we want true reform across the education landscape, it's more than the structure of three bodies. It's how these three bodies work across with each other. And I'm going to use a specific example about the separation of inspection. But really importantly, how these three organisations work across government and with other key stakeholders in Scottish education. And a specific example of that, we are supportive of the decision for a move to an independent inspectorate, but that doesn't mean that the inspectorate and the refocused Education Scotland sit in isolation and can't talk to each other in a reformed landscape space. The relationships between an independent inspectorate, Education Scotland, Qualification Scotland and others will be fundamental to the success that we're all looking to achieve.
Thank you. Okay.
Gillian Mackay now, please. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. The confusion of two Gillians. If I can come to Fiona, the current SQA board comprises 11 members, none of which, as far as I'm aware, are registered teachers, and none have any experience of undertaking a current SQA qualification. I welcome the bill's provisions to add teachers and learners to the board, although I think this should be expanded so a majority on the board are registered teachers. How do you think the new board should act on these provisions to ensure the new Qualification Scotland is more engaged with these groups compared to the SQA?
So first of all, I am a member of the board by virtue of my role as chief executive, but I'm not responsible for making appointments to the board. That is the responsibility of ministers, of Scottish ministers. So the composition of the board and the makeup of the board is not my responsibility. It's the responsibility of Scottish ministers. I will seek to answer the question, but I think it's important that I highlight that at the moment. And I don't think it is correct to say that there are no teachers on the board. We do have an existing head teacher on the board and a former principal of a college on the board, for example. It is worth noting that an appointments process has just concluded for five new board members, and I think there was a very clear expectation that educator experience was sought. So the composition of the board may change in quite short order in relation to the vacancies that are being filled. Obviously the board have a very specific set of responsibilities, and of course that's also set out in the provisions of the bill and is set out for all public bodies, and the board have a very important role in providing oversight and direction and with a direct accountability to the Scottish Government in relation to the way in which at the present time SQA and in due course Qualification Scotland delivers on its responsibility. That relationship is set out through a framework document. I mentioned the corporate plan and the prospectus for change, which has just been approved by ministers. So that sets the context under which we deliver as an executive NDPB. I hope that's answered your question, but I'm probably quite in one sense limited in what I can say in relation to appointments to the board.
It answers it to a certain extent. What I'm kind of looking for is similar to what John Mason was asking earlier on about how we actually drive that cultural yes. change. And some of that is structural in terms of yes. who's on the board and things, but it's also about how the approach to engaging with learners and teachers goes forward. And I accept that there's currently a learners panel and things like that as well, but that learners panel is quite small comparative to the spread of learners across across Scotland. So how can that ongoing feedback to the board, to other bodies within the New Qualifications Scotland, actually be made more accessible and welcoming to those learners and teachers to make sure that that ongoing feedback can be taken forward?
Yeah. I think what's come through from the discussions already this morning, both from me and from my fellow panel members, is that the board, the bill is not unimportant. Of course, it's very important. The statutory underpinning for, certainly for the organisation that I lead, is actually really important. So my responsibilities at the present time are very much framed within the 1996 Act, which was to establish the SQA. And the role of Qualifications Scotland will obviously be framed within the legislative structure that's set out following the scrutiny and enactment of the bill, of the legislation. But I think as I've sought to highlight, and I think my fellow panel members have sought to highlight, legislation is necessary, but it is not sufficient to make the kinds of changes that we want that we all have an ambition to achieve. So the formal structures are not unimportant; they are important. The governance of our organisations is important. But I think what we're also highlighting is the importance of how we execute our functions, how we exercise those statutory functions, and the bill, as I said, does provide the scaffolding through which we can build a new approach. The only thing I think it's important to highlight is I've talked about this at previous committee appearances, I suppose it's particular in previous committee appearances where the focus of the questioning has been on results, on the results from the previous year. Results Day is a day of celebration for many, but not all. I think, and teachers will also feel the responsibility of how their learners perform year on year. So the functions of SQA and in due course the functions of Qualifications Scotland, I think it's also really important to recognise that we have to carry out those functions without fear or favour, and we need to award qualifications on the basis that is set out in the legislation. And that can lead to some tensions between educators, learners and the organisation delivering them. And that's not unique to Scotland. That also exists elsewhere. So I think it's also important to highlight the need to ensure that the legislation also is clear about what our responsibilities are. And those responsibilities are serious, and it requires us sometimes to deliver quite difficult messages, but it should be in a culture of engagement and a culture of openness and transparency.
Okay. Thank you, Gillian Mackay. And leading on, I think Gillian Hamilton stated earlier that the legislation wasn't sufficient. She says it wasn't required to make some of the changes that were needed. Can I come to Willie Rennie now, please? Thanks.
This is to Fiona Robertson. You'll have heard some of the comments in previous evidence sessions where they've commented about the accreditation function remaining within the Qualifications Scotland. What's your response to those comments?
Ultimately, it is a choice. It is a choice whether the accreditation and regulatory function of the new organisation remains within Qualifications Scotland as it is within SQA or not. The government has set out its reasons for it remaining within one organisation and remaining within the new qualifications body. But it is a choice. I think it's interesting. I mean, the policy memoranda to the bill, and I would cite paragraph 133 in particular, does actually highlight that no significant concerns were raised in relation to this issue at the time that the bill was drafted. I think it has. I accept that the original recommendation from Ken Muir was around that separation. But there are important issues here of function and form. And there are issues here in relation to what the accreditation and regulation function of the qualifications body does. That's the first thing. And its scope. And I am certainly keen that the scope of the accreditation function is expanded. And then there are issues about where it sits. And I have to say I'm a fan of form following function. So I think it is important for us to consider as a system what the scope of accreditation and regulation is, and then to consider where it sits.
So you've described the circumstances very well, but you've not given me your view. Do you feel uncomfortable that the accreditation, which assesses the functions of other parts of the body, remain within the same organisation? Do you think that's... Are you comfortable with that? Has there ever been a moment where you've thought, this should be separate, this should not be with me, this should be another organisation?
I can give the committee assurance that accreditation operates separately from the awarding part of SQA. And I think it's also important to highlight that the accreditation function also either accredits or regulates a large number of other awarding bodies that operate in Scotland. But its scope is limited. It is a voluntary model, with the exception of Scottish Vocational Qualifications, SVQs, licence to practice qualifications, and some security industry qualifications. So it is largely an voluntary model. I would actually like it to see it not as a voluntary model, because actually if we're thinking about learners being at the centre, and that's been a focus of this discussion to date, then the quality and integrity of all qualifications offered in Scotland, irrespective of provider, is absolutely critical. And so as chief executive, where I do have responsibilities for oversight of the regulatory function of SQA, I think that's really important. I go back to that point about that there's a choice. The SQA's position in responding to the original consultation with respect to the bill was the view that we thought it could remain together, and that is the decision that the Scottish Government has reached. However, I think if there are important issues of public confidence in relation to qualifications, and there is a perception that the regulatory function of the organisation impacts on that confidence in qualifications, then I think that is something that should be considered.
Well, that's quite interesting. So you've indicated that if there was an issue of public confidence, perhaps it should be separated and put into another body. And I understand your point about voluntary versus another approach. I understand that. But you're indicating that if there is an issue of public confidence, that perhaps it could be separated.
I think it's a slightly nuanced point. I think my point is that goes back to that point about it being a choice.
Yeah.
But I think it needs to be informed by function.
Mm-hmm.
But the public confidence of our qualification system is precious. I can give the committee assurance that accreditation works separately from awarding. But if there's a perception that is otherwise, or there's a perception that actually the same organisation can't do that job, then I think there is a legitimate consideration around whether separation is appropriate.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Pam Duncan Glancy, over to yourself now. Thanks.
Thank you. And firstly, please let me put on the record my apologies to the convener, other committee members and the panel for arriving slightly late this morning. I was stuck in traffic, but nonetheless, I'm really sorry for the disruption caused. On the point of confidence, actually, I just want to share a few things that you will probably have seen in the evidence, because I'm sure you'll have read it anyway. And this is specifically for Fiona Robertson. The EIS have said in their submission that the actions of the SQA have inflicted significant damage upon its relationship with the profession, which now largely view the organisation with cynicism and suspicion. The SSTA has said the SQA is adrift from teachers, and the SLS has said that we question why the chair of the SQA will automatically become the chair of Qualifications Scotland because it cannot transfer lock, stock and barrel to the new body. So given this, and given what you've just said, do you accept that public confidence and teacher confidence in the organisation is not what it should be?
I'm aware that many of those points have actually been covered earlier on in the responses to other members. So if you could maybe pick up on some of the newer points, that would be helpful in the interest of time. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to repeat what I've already
saying
said.
What we've said already, Fiona.
You know, I mean, I think I've set out my response substantially in response to those on those points. Confidence in qualifications remains high in the products that we're responsible for, and you know, so the national qualifications and other qualifications remains very high. And interestingly, I mean, I think that the work that we're doing around our engagement, I think, is showing improvement. We do engage both routinely and frequently with professional associations and others, and indeed we were meeting with the EIS just yesterday, the EIS senior team just yesterday. But it goes back to that point about it's engagement's not an event. It needs to be both deep and broad. It needs to feel every day, and the profession needs to feel listened to. And we need to make sure, not just through the provisions in the bill, but also through our ongoing work, that we're seeking to do that.
Thank you, and apologies if I was seeking to ask you to go over old ground. I wasn't. I may have missed part of it, as you're aware. Leading from that, then, and looking at the involvement of teachers specifically, a former history teacher has contacted me and others, and members around the table and across the Parliament will be aware of the concerns around the history paper, as I know you, the SQA is as well, and you've highlighted that in your letter to the committee this morning. One of the comments they made was around the change in what they say is the change in marking regime. It's absolutely criminal, and clearly largely due to a change in the standard for the Scottish paper made during the marking process and not communicated with schools. Another said, a teacher from a forum, I heard a horror story from a teacher who was forced out from marking in 2023 after questioning what was going on. So can I ask Fiona Robson, what is your response to that? And can you set out how the profession is currently involved in the development and review of current qualifications?
Okay. So in relation to higher history in particular, I've obviously also read and received concerns have been raised in relation to higher history, and that's why I have moved to undertaking a review which is looking at marking standards in 2024, and I think that's important for the reasons I've set out around public confidence in our qualification system. Now, I think it's really important in saying that that I also highlight the need to ensure that review can be taken forward in the appropriate way. There are a variety of views in relation to these matters, and actually the full spectrum of views in relation to these matters. You've highlighted, obviously, some correspondence that you've received that has been critical, but there are a variety of views, and I think it's important to highlight that, you know, the marking team for higher history comprises of around 200 teachers, and that includes, you know, principal assessor, senior marking team and others. So the marking, the standardisation, the production of marking instructions is a teacher-led process. But it is really important, given the concerns that have been raised, and that includes concerns that have been raised with me directly, that we are taking action to consider those issues. And if action is required, we will take action. But I do think it's important for us to be sensitive to the fact, and I know you'll appreciate this, to be sensitive to the fact that, that at the heart of all of this is 10,000 learners who undertook higher history this year. And I need to make sure that we are ensuring that any consideration of these issues is based on evidence, not assertion, on evidence. And we are looking into those matters, and we will report on those matters as soon as we can.
Thank you.
In the interest of, sorry, Pam, in the interest of time, I need to move to Evelyn Tweed now, please. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. And good morning, panel, and thanks for all your answers so far. If I could direct this question to Gillian. How will the greater independence of the inspectorate change the approach of the inspectorate in the future? What might it look like?
So I think Janie's probably better placed to answer that.
Okay.
And so I'll maybe follow from Janie, but pass to Janie first.
Sorry.
I do have a view, but I'll pass to Janie first.
Okay, that's fine.
Thank you. Good morning. I think there are a number of aspects that are set in legislation that are going to change for the inspectorate going forward. I think firstly, it's the separation of the inspection functions from Education Scotland, and we know historically there has been criticism of, you know, having the improvement body and the inspection in the one body was accused of marking its own homework. So you'll see that with the inspection functions coming out to that. So that commitment to moving the inspection functions out of that, I suppose, sets out that commitment for the inspectorate being independent. I think there's also elements around the changes set out in legislation around the powers that will move to that office holder of the chief inspector. And actually setting up that office holder in itself is going to strengthen the independence. And I suppose, you know, we've been talking about culture, and it's really important that children, young people, adult learners, parents, stakeholders have trust that the inspectorate is independent. So all of the steps to strengthen and make that independence much more explicit is really helpful. We're seeing elements of the inspectorate where aspects around the focus and the frequency, those were areas that are set out in the bill that will move to the chief inspector to take forward. I think we're also seeing some changes in terms of accountability for the inspectorate as well, in terms of the reporting. The reporting annually to Parliament, but also reporting much more regularly on the performance of Scottish education as well. A key change, and I touched on this earlier, but a key change is around the setup in legislation of the Advisory Council, which is really important, and that's really quite significant. And I think it's really important that hearing the diverse views, providing, just as the inspectors and inspectorate provide support and constructive challenge, then the inspectorate should welcome that as well from stakeholders. So there's a number of different ways that there will be changes in the work of the inspectorate going forward.
Thanks, Jane. Gillian, would you like to
come? I would have said very similar, so in the interest of time,
no,
I would.
Okay. Yeah.
It's all right if we are interested in hearing as well, but I'm just very aware that we've spent 2/3 of the session on the SQA, so I'm trying to move the discussion forward, so carry on.
So very briefly then, in addition to what Janie has said, the other piece that I would have spoken about is the work that we're already doing in terms of that separation. So I talked earlier about not standing still when I took up post and when Janie took up the interim chief inspector post. So we've been operating as an organisation for almost a year now with the decision to be one organisation, two distinct functions, recognising that in autumn 25 there will be the stand-up of an independent inspectorate. So we've already been looking at the governance, the oversight, the engagement with stakeholders, separating that off, which actually has been well received by stakeholders that we're engaging with.
Thank you for that. And do you feel, or should the new inspectorate retain the current powers of inspection for funded ELC?
I think it's really important that we think about the reason why an inspectorate exists in Scottish education, and that is really to focus on ensuring that every child, every learner, every adult learner, every young person receives the highest quality of education. And therefore, it then follows that where children and young people and adult learners are receiving education, that that should be as part of that journey. Because that's who we're there for, that's why we exist as an inspectorate. So it's really important that we think about that. I think also crucially, in our work, and as we take forward Curriculum for Excellence, we have the early level of Curriculum for Excellence. We have such a focus now on our curriculum improvement cycle, reviewing the curriculum to make sure that it's fit for purpose, that it's developing the skills and the knowledge and the competencies that our learners need. And therefore, it's really important that for the inspectorate to be looking at that journey that the learner takes right the way through early learning and childcare, right the way through school and beyond. So I think it is important that where education is delivered, and it is in early learning and childcare, that the education inspectorate has a role to play.
Lovely on that one. George, Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and hello again. Basically, last week we heard much from the evidence that was given was about the independence of the inspectorate itself. And some of my colleagues in here have got some concerns over ministerial control. I try to assure them that you're far too busy as a minister to plan world domination, but they've still got these concerns that possibly it's a power grab. So how often, in your experience, probably directed at Janie, has the government actually, or ministers, have directed you the work of the inspectorate? You know, have they said, going to go and check out that school there? You know, has there been anything like that at all from the government?
Yes, there has been, because the powers sit with ministers at the moment, and predominantly where we see that at the moment is where there has been a significant risk to children and young people. Mm-hmm. And that has been carried out under Section 66 of legislation. More often that the inspectorate will provide advice along with other bodies. So you can see it in terms of advice from myself and my inspectors linking in with the registrar of independent schools in times where there is accommodation needed. You'll see advice from the care inspectorate coming into that mix. And it's where, I suppose, the different bodies engaging with a particular school have significant concerns that we feel that the ministers need to cause an inspection. And at the moment, it's predominantly in response to significant risk.
Just to follow on from that, Section 66, how frequently has that been used by ministers, or how often has that happened?
So in the past year, it's been used once.
Uh-huh. And is it normally like high-profile cases that we'll probably all be aware of because they've become kind of everybody's understood what's going on because it's become newsworthy?
Not always. There are elements. So in the past 3 years, there have been around two inspections. Some of them have not been high profile. Some of them have not made any headlines or media. But what we've been able to do is to go in and actually understand really quickly what's happening in a school. When we carry out those inspections, we take two approaches to them. We either go in unannounced, so we turn up at the school with necessary information to give to the school, or we give the school very short notice. Mm-hmm. And so it happens really, really quickly to take that work forward. And depending on what we find, the registrar then may give advice to ministers to impose requirements or conditions on the school, or it may be actually that we are confident and what was taking place in the school.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Kidd, Bill Kidd now, please.
Thank you, convener. Thanks very much for all the evidence. I think it's been very helpful. Just two quick, I think, questions. The first one, I think, would probably first go to Janie McManus. What are the new approaches to inspection being considered? You know, actually in the actual work of the inspectors, what's the new approaches you're considering taking?
So we're looking at a number of new approaches at the moment coming across in a range of different sectors. One of the aspects that we're looking to be taking forward, and we're just about to start that off, is the review of our school inspection approach. And what we're going to take with that approach is we're going to look at it of what I call end to end, from start right the way to the finish of it. So we're going to look at the quality improvement framework that we currently use, which is, people refer to it as HIGI is 4, is what it's. So we're going to look at that framework. That framework sets out the range of areas of a school provision that inspectors may look at, but also it capitalises on the range of areas that a school might want to evaluate their own performance and their own improvements on. So we want to make sure that our quality frameworks support both inspection but also self-evaluation, self-improvement for the school itself. So we're going to be looking at that framework, and we want to make sure that it's fit for purpose, it's relevant. We also want to make sure it's adaptable and agile, and we can use it flexibly as we're going forward. I think I heard a range of evidence, people talking about uncertainty in education and things changing for children and young people. So we need to make sure that the frameworks that we use are adaptable and flexible, and we can use them in different ways. So we're going to look at that framework, and that, I suppose, will set out the areas that the inspectorate can focus on going forward. So that's the first area that we're looking at. We're also going to look at the models and methodologies that we use. So I suppose it's what happens during the inspection. So we're going to look at our models and our methodologies. We will look at what's working well just now, because we get positive feedback about aspects of our model and our methodology that is working well. So we'll look at that. And we'll also look at areas that we need to improve on and we need to do differently. We want to be more dynamic, we want to be more flexible, so how do we do that through our models? We also then want to look at how we report our findings. What do the reports look like? And there's an element that I suppose is quite exciting. How do we use digital technologies to report our findings in different ways? And then the final area that we want to look at is what do we do both to celebrate success, where things are really good, where we're seeing strong practice, where we see effective practice, how do we get that message out into the system? But also if things are not of a suitable quality, how do we then follow up that as well? So that's what I said when we're looking at that end to end. So we're going to take it in a couple of approaches. What we want to do is actually, first of all, listen to stakeholders, listen to teachers, practitioners, learners, what their current views are about all of those different aspects. What's working well for them? But begin to think about what are the opportunities that we can take forward in terms of our work. And we'll take those views and that will shape what we do. I specifically haven't put a detailed timescale on the areas, because I want to hear what those views are first, because that will then determine the scale of the work that we need to carry out, because we need to get it right. We need to get it right for children and young people. And then working with our stakeholders, we'll then begin to develop and draft what those frameworks and what those models will be going forward. And then we'll need to test them out. Because some of the areas, it's when you're putting them into practice that, again, we need to look at further refinement as well. And then I suppose the final element of that, with any new change that we want to put in, is we want to see, is it having the desired impact? Is it working? does it feel different for people? Are people able to use inspection to support their own improvement? Does it enable us to gather the evidence that enable us to report on the quality of education? Do the new approaches enable us to reach a greater number of children and young people? Because some of the feedback that we get from children and young people in schools that have been inspected is that, yes, we knew the inspectors were there, we saw them, but we didn't always get a chance to speak to them and engage with them. So there are really some really powerful opportunities that we're going to have as an inspector is taking that and taking that work forward. So that gives a bit of an overview.
Well, thank you very much. I mean, you've got a lot of work there, it sounds a bit, but no, thank you very much indeed for that. A controversial one, I think, actually, for Gillian Hamilton, potentially, maybe not. What is your view of the suggestion that the inspectorate should be able to inspect the function and performance of other national bodies?
So I was reading what you were saying, Ms Duncan Glancy, about reading the evidence. I was reading that in the evidence last night, actually. And I think in a network learning system, when we're all working together, we should be open to working with other organisations to have a fresh perspective. So I don't think that's that controversial a question.
OK. Right. But you're going to do it anyway, right?
Well, I'm not an inspector.
Sorry. But the functions looking at the performance of other national bodies is something which is, not you personally, but I mean the organisations looking into it, yes.
Yeah.
OK. Great. Well, thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Jeannie, do you have thoughts on that inspection of other bodies?
I'm going to bring it back for the reason why the inspectorate exists and whether it is the best body to inspect the function of another organisation. That would bring in a new area that we would need to be suitably resourced for to take that forward. I'm much more interested in areas around the difference policies and practice are having on children and young people and adult learners. And for me, it's the interface between work that's taken forward and what difference that is making to children and young people. And I think that's the area, because you could spend so much time looking at a structure or a function or an area, but I'm really much more interested in what's happening to our learners.
Okay, well, so it's a delivery of the heart of the whole thing. Well, thank you very much indeed for that. Thank you.
No, thank you. Can I come to Jackie Dunbar now, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I think my question first will be for Gillian and Janie. I'm not sure which one will be best to respond. So, but could you briefly outline the plans that are currently in place to make sure that the remainder of Education Scotland is responsive to our learners and practitioners? And how will those plans help improve the support currently given to our local authorities, teachers and schools?
I think I'll start with that one. We probably should have said something really briefly about the relationship between my role and Janie's role at the beginning. That might have
Sorry, I'm new
helped.
To this committee.
So in my current role as Interim Chief Executive, I remain the accountable officer for the entirety of the organisation, which includes the inspectorate function and the part of the organisation that will become the refocused Education in Scotland. But Janie has responsibility as the Interim Chief Inspector for the oversight of inspection. We probably should have said that 10 questions ago.
Said it in my pre-brief.
Because that might help then in terms of the questions. So in my current role, I am overseeing the entirety, but also specifically the work as Education Scotland refocuses to become the refocused organisation. And I think members will know that the majority of the functions of that new organisation have been confirmed. They were confirmed in a GIQ just before the end of before recess. So the primary purpose of the organisation will be to lead the curriculum, including the curriculum improvement cycle, provision of resources to support high quality learning and teaching, support professional learning, thriving professional learning sector through a national framework, and importantly, coming to your question, to work with local authorities to inform approaches to wellbeing, inclusion, behaviour and better enabling support for those with ESN. And linking that then, the organisation does and will have a really important role in informing, sharing and promoting the wider approaches to improve it, to improvement of or to closing the poverty related attainment gap. So coming then to your question, hopefully that context helps. But the work that Janie has already set out in terms of the reviewing frameworks, the changed ways of working, the heads of inspection, the senior colleagues in the inspection teams already have close links and close working relationships with our senior regional advisers who oversee the local authority support and targeting of resources, etc. So there's already an intelligence flow to enable us to target our support and resources. That should be improved, given the information that Janie set out around the sharing of findings, getting them into the system. But colleagues are already using that information in their work with directors, with heads of service and local authorities to identify the resource that we have to provide support. Often Education Scotland has been criticised in the past for trying to be all things to all people and can provide a solution to every area. Hopefully the clarity around the functions, the clearer role for Education Scotland, the removal of the need to be all things to all people enables us to target that resource. But importantly, I'm going to pick up an ELC coming back to Ms Tweed's question earlier. I think we all know and appreciate that ELC is an area that we would want to be supporting really strongly right now. When we hear from the profession, we hear about challenges for the workforce. Our team in Education Scotland, as it currently stands, is a team of three people working in the early years space. So a refocused organisation cannot do this on its own. And I talked earlier about the importance of working with local authorities and other national organisations. So one of the specific actions that we've already taken is to recruit a pool of Education Scotland associates. And these are colleagues working in the profession, in early years establishments across our schools, to bolster our existing expertise and knowledge so that we can work in an extended team to support the specific areas where people are asking. And just to come back to the other aspect of your question, you asked about the plans that are in place to do that. So Education Scotland had a corporate plan in place covering until 2024, which was the original timescale, if you remember, for the reform period. We've extended that for a further year to an annual action plan that takes account of the refocusing of the organisation, the key functions, so that we have plans in place not only to be able to deliver that support, but to be able to monitor the impact of that support.
Okay, thank you. Jeannie?
I think Gillian mentioned earlier the curriculum improvement cycle and the work that's taken forward. I think that's perhaps a really good example. Since for myself taking up post, and that's, I suppose, separation from the chief inspector from the chief executive position, because it was held by one person previous to Gillian and myself. So that separation element, one of the areas that we have been working closely on is what are the things that we can begin to test out in this period that would look at how to different organisations can work, but being really mindful of the work that certainly for an inspectorate, we don't want to sit in isolation to other areas of the system. It's really important. We are all in this together and we're all about supporting improvement, but we do it and carry it out in different ways. And so part of the aspects of the work around the curriculum improvement cycle work, which Education Scotland, the Inspectorate and SQA, we're all involved in that and that together, and we all sit in the group to take that work forward. So that work is being led by a team in Education Scotland. The Inspectorate will provide evidence to help inform the possible changes to the curriculum going forward. So I suppose it will be a bit of a stakeholder view to give evidence to support that work, but also as the cycle gets up and running, then as part of the inspection functions, it will look at where there are changes in the curriculum, what impact are those changes having on children and young people? So I suppose that's a bit of showing how different bodies can work together. We'll need to work out going forward, you know, how we share information as bodies and whether we need to set up memorandums of understanding so that we are making best use of the evidence that we have in the education system, that we can work towards the same goal.
Okay, thank you. Do we have time to take Fiona in, convener?
Only if it's a succinct response, if you don't mind, Fiona.
It's really just to highlight that joint working. So, you know, the point about curriculum improvement, and I think this was a point that Cabinet Secretary made last week about the looking at the curriculum improvement cycle, well, what implications does that have for the qualifications that we want to see going forward? Similarly, I was at an event with colleagues from Education Scotland and HMIE with directors of education, where we're looking at the joined upness, if you like, of both the evidence, qualitative and quantitative, to help inform improvement. So I think looking at evidence where the national bodies are working together, but also working with the wider system to bring all the evidence that we have to bear to help local authorities, schools and others drive improvements, really important.
Okay.
Thanks.
And my other question would be, how are the current bodies making sure that they're currently meeting the public sector equality duty that's in place? I'm not sure who wants to take that one first.
Jamie? Or no, Fiona, you go first, if you don't mind.
Yep. Yeah. So I think we've done quite a lot of work on this over the last few years, in particular around equality impact assessments, also children's rights and wellbeing impact assessments as well, and we've also increased our resource in this area. We also have really important responsibilities, obviously as an employer as well, but that's what we've sought to do is really around mainstreaming all our equalities work and making sure that we're doing that and alongside any policy announcements that we provide EQIAs and child rights wellbeing assessments. And of course on results day in recent years we've also provided an equalities monitoring report which looks at results by different protected characteristics, for example. So it has been a very core part of our work and in ensuring that we meet our statutory obligations in that respect. Thanks.
Gillian, and then Jamie.
So similarly, we have a really good team in Education Scotland who have worked extensively over the last few years to move away from a view that that is the responsibility of that team, but it's the responsibility of the entirety of the organisation. Mm-hmm. So as Fiona said, the requis would be standard practice in the work that we do. We also have a responsibility to build the capacity of the profession in those areas, such as work on the UNCRC. We have an excellent building racial literacy programme for practitioners across Scotland. And the team are working hard in a transition phase to make sure that that work continues and that the refocused organisation and inspectorate are well placed to continue that work.
Okay, and just to add to that, so a couple of areas that we're looking at is that through our inspection programmes, we look at equalities and how well our learners have been served and the equalities work is taken forward. Another key area that we will be taking forward, both in the review of our inspection frameworks, is the emphasis on UNCRC. And so one of the areas is that all of our inspectors have received updated training on UNCRC, so that we are looking at how we factor that in to our work going forward as well.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, convener.
Willie, have you got something briefly? Because I've got a couple of things.
Yeah, it's just following up on the ELC and the care inspectorate relationship. You said it was really important to work in partnership. I don't know if you have memory of the care inspecting issuing a framework in the middle of the inspectorate agreeing with the care inspector on a joint approach. Do you know how that came about and have those relationships improved since?
Yes, we work closely with the Care Inspectorate, not just in the ELC, but in other areas as well. So we had been taking forward so work on a shared inspection framework. Then we had paused that work, and I think it was in that the period where the work had paused that Care Inspectorate, but they would be better placed to answer that work. But that work has resumed, and we're taking forward the work with the shared inspection framework currently. With the sector feeding into that.
Okay, thank you.
Jeannie, you've spoken a lot about a lot of new approaches that you're taking and a lot of developments that you're going through right now. Do you have any thoughts on how that might maybe curtail or tie the hands of any future organisation if you're making the changes at this point in time?
No, not at this point, because in terms of making changes in an inspectorate, it does take a time to do that. I'm confident in the work that we're doing and the engagement with stakeholders that we will have very clear evidence as an evidence organisation of the views of stakeholders as well. But also, recently, the permanent post for the permanent chief inspector was advertised, and I think the timescales for that to be in place in the next few months. Okay. So I don't feel that will curtail any of it.
Gillian, have you got a brief question as well on something?
A very quick one, yeah, mm-hmm. If that's okay. There's a lot of reform going on, and the bill's only one part of it, and arguably most of the reform that government wants to take forward is out of that legislative space. So does the panel think we're doing this in the right order? The legislation is coming, and then other non-legislative reform work, or would you have liked to have seen something different? Fiona?
Well, I'll perhaps highlight the response I provided to Mr. Rennie earlier. I'm a fan of forum following function. So I mean, I think if we were looking back a few years, I think the Hayward Review, from the perspective of my organisation, the Hayward Review coming first, because I think in establishing a new organisation, it's really important to understand what the organisation is responsible for, and the context, the policy context, which is set out in order to inform the new organisation and the success of the new organisation. So I'm pleased now that we have a response to that review, and that will set a context for Qualification Scotland. But that point about function and form is really important.
Yeah. I think it's really important. And I think in the period we're going through, I think it's really important, particularly for an inspectorate, that it has enough scope to be flexible and adaptable, because the education system will always change. There'll always be new approaches. There'll always be challenges in the system. There are also societal changes that will take place. So it's really important that an inspectorate isn't hampered from being flexible and adaptable, and I suppose dynamic in that approach as well. And I think it's something that we're certainly living with over the past few years, and I think that will become the norm, that we've got that change and churn will take place.
And I would repeat the point I made earlier about the legislation being part of the reform mm-hmm. process and journey, but stressing again that our organisation has not stood still waiting for the legislation piece before moving to the next piece. So that reform is happening mm-hmm. at the same time, ultimately for the good of Scotland's young people and the profession.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Can I ask you, Gillian, briefly as well, if you don't mind, what's the benefit of having the Curriculum Support Agency separate from the Scottish Government? And how much distance do you think is appropriate in terms of that distance?
So Education Scotland will remain an executive agency of government. So the structures, the executive agency ways of working will remain in place. I think the Scottish Government and Education Scotland bring unique perspectives to the curriculum improvement cycle. So we have expert policy makers, etc., in government, and we have a whole team of educationalists in Education Scotland with a background in leadership, curriculum development, etc., working with the profession mm-hmm. in that space. So I think those roles are complementary in the curriculum improvement cycle and should work well.
Okay, thanks. Liam Kerr, please.
Fiona Robertson, a very quick question. You've said in your letter to this committee that investment is needed, and you've given a specific example. How much investment is needed? What's the figure that you're after? And is there any indication it will be forthcoming?
So there are a number of investments that will be required. So a business case was submitted to government in relation to digital investment. And we've had permission to spend some of our existing budget on that. But we were looking, you know, we're looking for probably about £10 million in relation to digital investment, because some of our infrastructure, some of our legacy systems go back to the establishment of SQA in the 90s. So I think if we were to realise the ambitions set out in the provisions of the bill, that investment would be very welcome.
So if the government doesn't provide it, you won't realise the ambitions?
Sorry, if there's not further investment, that we will not realise the ambitions. But in relation to qualifications development, we've set out, and it was set out in the Cabinet Secretary's statement last week, that we are looking at rationalisation of the portfolio of qualifications. But again, if we're to establish effectively a life cycle of qualifications to ensure that we do have the agility and that we are making changes as part of our business as usual, we will need both investment and we will need a smaller portfolio of qualifications in order to do that. The committee will be aware that there are very challenging financial issues that all public bodies are facing, SQA included, and I'm sure I can speak for my panel members as well. So that will involve difficult choices.
Okay, thank you. Well, finally, just to a quick ask of you, Fiona, you've highlighted that the SQA involves teachers in developing awards and revisions of school qualifications currently. So I'm hoping that you can send some details of that to the committee in writing, if you
Absolutely.
Don't mind. Okay, that's super.
Very happy to do that.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your evidence this morning, panel, and we will now suspend the meeting for 12 minutes to allow our witnesses to leave and for our second panel of witnesses to come in. Thank you very much.
Welcome back. And can I welcome our second set of witnesses this morning? We have Lawrence Finlay, Director of Education and Children's Services, Aberdeenshire Council, but today is representing the Association of Directors of Education in Scotland, we ADES throughout the morning, and Anne Keenan, Assistant Secretary from the Educational Institute of Scotland, EIS, and Graham Hutton, General Secretary, School Leaders Scotland, SLS, and Stuart Hunter, President of Scottish Secondary Teachers Association, SSTA. Thank you for joining us all this morning, and apologies for the slight delay. That is worse than sausages. I hope the official report picks that one up. Apologies. Wonder what will be picked up. Anyway, we're going to move straight to questions from members, just to get away from me and my red face. Pam Duncan Glancy.
Oh, no.
Sorry, it's Liam again. And then, okay.
You're having a grand day.
I'm having a really good morning. Thank you.
Good morning, panel. Graham Hutton, I'll come to you first, please, because the SLS has submitted, thank you for all of your submissions that I'll be referring to, but the SLS submission, you talk about how reform is overdue, and you actually speak quite positively about some of the things that are happening. One of the things that we explored earlier was that fundamentally the same people from the SQA are going to be popping up on the other side of reform. So does the SLS get any sense that the SQA and the people running it accept the criticisms in their entirety that have been levelled, and in any event, whether those currently presiding over that those issues are able and indeed willing to address it going forward?
I think you've asked a very cogent question about whether they can transfer from being the SQA to being Qualifications Scotland. Both Professor Muir, Louise Hayward think that there has to be a complete reform of the SQA, and we all agree on that. It did not deliver in the past. It has been an authority which has been quite secretive, which has been quite conscientious, I would say, in what it's done, but it has not been open and transparent and open and reacting positively to criticism. And I think there has been in the last few years, particularly since the COVID pandemic and the ACM, a movement to listen to people a bit more. And I see that as a positive aspect of how it's moving forward. They're certainly going out into schools. They're certainly consulting more with SLS, with the other unions, I think, as well. And there is more of a collaborative, consultative approach than there has been in the past, but that has to continue. I think there has to be a culture change there, and a culture change is required with more openness, more integrity, owning up to mistakes and seeking advice and support from other stakeholders. There's no shame, as my father would say, in asking for help and advice when you're in the sticky wicket, and I think the SQA at times has bricked itself into a corner, as it were, and felt unable to ask for more help and support. And I think that is slowly changing. If you come back to, sometimes you have to separate the post from the post holders, and the posts have to be very similar posts in a new qualification, because you still need the director of this and the director of that, operations and whatnot. But there has to be leadership there, and the leadership has to accept that the status quo, as it was in the SQA, was not working. They were delivering many ways for the young people in ways, because they do their job very thoroughly, very conscientiously, as I said, and I worked for the SQA for 25 years as an appointee, and I know the ins and outs of how they work, but I also know how reluctant they were often to give answers out with their own organisation. So I think there does need to be a different direction. I think they're moving in that way, and there needs to be more interaction with young people and teachers. And the teachers, remember, there may be about 1,000 people working for SQA who are permanent employees, but there are thousands more in schools who actually do the groundwork, who do the marking, who do the setting, who do the examining. And they have to have a much bigger say in how that's run. And I think one of the things, when I first started working for the SQA way back in last century, then the qualifications managers were all, had all been teachers, principal teachers sometimes in schools and new schools and how schools function. And that's been missing for the last few years. Now, there is a salary issue there because a principal teacher in a school may not be recompensed at the same level if they go into the SQE, and that's a worry that they have, I know that. But I think there has to be more support and more involvement, I would say, of teachers and young people in the authority. So there needs to be a change, there needs to be a culture change, there probably needs to be some new people coming in, and I think we've said that, new blood. There still has to be some continuity from what was happening before. There's no two ways about that, because you can't have a complete big bang and changeover. There's no alternative qualifications authority waiting in the wing to come in and take place of the SQA, unless you want to go down south and use one of them. But I can't see the current government doing that in a way. But there has to be some sort of continuity, but there has to be a different culture. There has to be a way of moving forward that takes in views from other people and being a bit more consultative.
Thank you. Lawrence Finlay and then Anne Keenan, I'll ask you the same question after Lawrence has answered. Again, I've noted your remarks in your submission, which are challenging. Looking at the bill as it's been drafted, do you think that the bill will address the concerns that were raised by the OECD and Muir and Hayward, and or achieve what those reports intended? Lawrence.
Yeah, thank you, and good morning, everyone. I would associate myself with the comments that Graham has made. I don't think the bill goes far enough in that it is primarily focusing on a structural change as opposed to a cultural change. And I won't repeat the points that Graham has made, but like Graham, worked for the SQA for many years as an appointee, as a marker. A significant cultural shift is required in terms of how the new qualifications agency works with the system, with all stakeholders, with schools, with learners and their families, with local authorities and so on and so forth. What I would say, however, is that I also sit on the Transitions Board on behalf of ADES, which is transitioning from the SQA to Qualifications Scotland. I have to say that the new chair of the board has really been focusing significantly on the need for cultural change. And I've been very impressed with that focus that she has put on culture. And at each Transitions Board, and we are meeting monthly, of course, given that the transition is due to take place next autumn, she always comes back to culture and the need for it to be a very different organisation, to look very differently, to feel very differently and to interact very differently with the system. And I guess for me, the proof of the success or otherwise of the bill will be in how that is monitored and evaluated on an ongoing basis. So within the bill, we read about the need for charters being developed in different groups of stakeholders, be they learners or staff themselves. These charters really need to be co-created with people, with young people, with staff and so on. And I would again go back to Graham's point that we need, I think the new qualifications agency needs to begin with the people they already have working for them. So we have many, many teachers in Aberdeenshire, for example, who work for the SQA as markers. That will be the same across the country. They've got a huge resource there, who've all got very strong, passionate beliefs in the qualifications system and how it should or should not operate. So I think getting those views would be a really good first step in terms of driving some of that cultural change. To go back to your initial question, does the bill go far enough? No, I don't think it does. I think there needs to be much greater focus on change, and I would go back to the recommendations that were made in the Muir report about separating the accreditation function from the awarding functions. So you do, in essence, end up with a bit of a monopoly in Scotland. So that's the one concern that's outstanding. In terms of culture, I do detect through that Transitions Board a real genuine drive from the new chair to really push that forward.
Thanks. Very grateful. Anne Keenan.
Thanks very much. No, in answer to your question, I don't think it meets the recommendations of the OECD, the Muir report, indeed the national discussion from Professors Alma Harris and Carol Campbell. I think the most refreshing thing about the Muir report was it could have been quite a dry report,
looking purely at structural and functional change, but instead Professor Muir addressed what was the elephant in the room, which was the importance of cultural change that has been referred to by my colleagues this morning, and I think that's absolutely key. But fundamentally in his report he also gave us a pathway. He spoke of key principles that had to be in place for there to be effective cultural change. He spoke of the importance of there being a transfer of power, a transfer of influence and of resourcing to teachers, to empower teachers, to put learners' voices at the centre of decision-making and effectively to give meaning to the empowerment agenda that we've all been discussing since 2017, but we haven't actually seen realised within education as yet. He spoke of the importance of time for collaboration for teachers, for greater trust in teacher professional judgment, and crucially of that consensual vision of what Scottish education was all about. And we saw that picked up in the national discussion by Professors Campbell and Harris, and they too echoed the need for cultural change. And I really liked the way they adopted their recommendation for human-centred educational improvement, with teachers and their professional judgment driving the changes and influencing the education sector. So they had a clear call to bring the joy back into teaching and for teachers to lead the way in that process. And both of those reports put and referenced the importance of teachers being central to decision making and, importantly, to governance of the national bodies, if there was going to be a restoration of trust in those national bodies. And in relation to the SQA, that trust is not there within the profession. Our members have raised concerns about the attentiveness, how the SQA listen to them. And there's a job of work to be done to restore and build that trust and confidence within the profession, within teachers, indeed within learners and families. And I think if we're going to do it, we have to take the principles that Professor Muir, Professor Alma Harris, Professor Campbell and Harris referred to, and we need to see them in the bill. And looking at the bill, I don't see those principles. I don't see empowerment in the governance structures. And we can go into this in more detail perhaps later on, but I don't see teacher voice in the membership. There has been some movement in terms of teacher representation on the membership of the New Qualifications Scotland, but I don't see it being creating sufficient empowerment to ensure that teacher voice is leading the way and is a majority in that capacity, bearing in mind that also teacher voice will represent and be cognisant of the interests of learners in that space. So there's those aspects in terms of governance. I think, you know, the advisory committees and the charters to which Lawrence has referred to, I think don't go far enough either. I think they need to be much stronger, and I can go into that in more detail if you wish subsequently. But overall, I think, it's falling short in terms of meeting the needs of those reports.
I'm very grateful. A final question, which I'll put to Stuart Hunter. You've heard quite a lot there about the cultural change. Do you, and the restoration of trust, do you and the SSTA think that the fix to that is legislative, or is it practical and on the ground? And in any event, given what you've heard, what should we be amending as a committee? What would you like to see change in this draft bill?
I think, first of all, I'm going to say I concur with all of my colleagues and everything that's been said. This bill does not go far enough. What do we need to change? Teachers are the educators. Teachers are the professionals. You have in Scotland some of the best qualified teachers in Europe and in some cases further afield. The OECD backs that up. Yet teachers are disconnected from the entire process. I'm going to use the SQA as an example to further back that up. The SQA employ hundreds, if not thousands, of teachers as markers. They are the employee of SQA whilst they're doing that. They also are part of a non-disclosure. They are not legally entitled to discuss any of the matters of the SQA outside of their employment. I have attended meetings with the SQA where some of our members are part of the SQA, two as an appointee, and have to declare a conflict of interest. How is that putting teachers at the heart? When we talk about the disconnect, what happens is that the SQA will turn around and say that they have consulted teachers, and it's often those who are employees of the SQA which gives us respectability. So going back to the idea, what do we need to do? We have the charter. A charter is meaningless, absolutely meaningless, unless it's backed up with legislation. There have to be consequences when you have a system that relies on education being carried out as it is mentioned in the bill and what is required of every partner. And that's the final point I'm going to make, semantics. There is a difference between a partner and a stakeholder. A stakeholder is often someone who's an interested party. A partner is at the centre. Teachers and the teaching profession are not partners. Every time you have some kind of major discussion, all the time, teachers are left on the side. You look at the various committees that this government and previous governments have actually established and ask yourself, how many of them are there representing the teaching profession? Often you will see that those who are the teaching profession and the experts are in the minority. Teachers are meant to be partners. And yes, we do need to have that enshrined in legislation. Thank you.
Very grateful. Convener.
Quite a difficult set of questions because we're talking about people's jobs, people's livelihoods. But I was pleased to hear that your experience, Lawrence and Graham, is that the SQA have attempted to change and you're seeing some of the benefits of that. But Graham, you indicated that there will still need to be a change of personnel. Can I be direct? Should the chair and the chief executive of the SQA be the chair and the chief executive of Qualification Scotland?
I think it's difficult to put the personalities aside, from the post. But I think there has to be, if the current chair is taking forward the culture and changing that culture now, as Lawrence has said, and which we have evidence of, then I don't see why not. But the problem is, when that job was advertised, did it actually state in it that there would be the chair of SQA and then the chair of the qualifications? Well, and whether that was made public or not, I don't know. I think it's very difficult to take a qualifications authority as it is now and have the same people at the top lead that in a different direction unless they're already showing that they want to lead that in that different direction. I think there maybe has to be the jobs advertised, and then the current people can apply for them, be interviewed, and take it forward that way. Because if they really are going to of the mind to change, they will convince people because of their background, because of their experience, and the way that they want to move forward at the moment.
So that's a change of your position, because you previously said you couldn't understand how the chair could continue from one to the other.
I still think that there's maybe a bit more politics in there as when this job was advertised, about what were the criteria there. I think there really has to be a complete change in many, many ways. We think that, but we're realistic in the fact that there are people in these posts at the moment and their livelihood also has to be taken into consideration. So if they are convinced, and they can convince an interview panel, that they will take their SQA forward in a different direction, then that's the decision that the interview panel would make at the end of the day. I still think that there needs to be a change, and it maybe is that there are other people in the authority who need to think about their position as well, how they're taking it forward, because it is a collective responsibility. It's the same in the school. You know, when you've got a head teacher and deputy, you're running the school together, you're taking things forward. So there has been a collective view there. It's how do we change that collective view and move things forward.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks. Pam, Duncan Glancy, do you want to pick up some threads on that?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for the information you've submitted in advance. I found it really, really helpful, and also the comments you've already made. I just want to pick up on a couple of things that's been said, and I don't know if anyone was following this morning's session, but one of the questions I asked Fiona Robertson was around the history paper. And on the basis of what I've just heard from Stuart Hunter and Graham Hutton, can I ask, the approach that they've taken to addressing some of the concerns that have come out of the history paper is to have the independent review, which the SQA is going to hold, and they're going to use their teachers, who are markers, to independently review this. Can I ask Stuart Hunter, do you think that's appropriate, and does that demonstrate a change in approach?
My question would be, and has already been raised in our education committee of the SSTA, how independent is independent? Because we have had issues in the past with papers, and we have no input into it. So my question would be, what do they mean by independence? At the moment, certainly within our education committee and from teachers who do teach history, there isn't a great deal of confidence in it. That's the consensus coming from our members in history.
In the particular the history in particular, or in
general? In the history paper in particular, but also in the independence overall, as to their ability to actually mark fairly. I think probably the easiest way to describe it is the review simply as, when they said that papers would be issued, that students would have the opportunity to see their papers. It's not a root and branch review of the markings. It's simply a totalling of the marks. That's not a review. That's where there's a lack of trust comes in.
And I think that's in the general appeal system as well.
Yes.
Yeah. Has the panel seen any indication of a change in approach from the SQA in the recent months and years?
Yeah. Thanks, and thanks for the question. I think it's fair to say that there's been much more visibility from senior staff within the SQA. I know that two members of senior staff from the SQA have visited schools in my local authority area. Well, one's met with head teachers, another one went to a school, met learners, met staff to listen to their concerns, to hear about their ideas for reform. And I know that other colleagues and other local authorities have had similar visits and had input from senior staff who are keen to hear from practitioners. So there has been a shift. That's something quite new that we haven't seen in previous years. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks. We've certainly, in recent months, we've seen much more visible engagement in terms of liaison with ourselves and headquarters at the EIS. We have been raising for a number of years issues around assessment arrangements and the bureaucracy and the workload in trying to get alternative assessment arrangements in exams for some of the most vulnerable students. That those pleas hadn't been responded to or given appropriate consideration in our view previously. However, within the last year, we have worked collaboratively with some senior staff and members of the SQE and engaged our subject specialist networks to listen to their concerns, and we put those concerns to the SQE, and a list of frequently asked questions has now been issued within the last month to address the concerns that we have been raising for a number of years. So we have seen that movement. We have engaged in liaison meetings with the SQE as recently as Monday of this week to raise a number of concerns that the profession have around a variety of topics and to seek to advance them. So seen some movement there. I think the issue really is coming back to the question of trust and whether it's too little too late. And I think there's a job of work to do now in ensuring that teachers in schools are receiving the support that they need, are given the assurance that this will be a listening Qualifications Scotland body moving forward, responsive to their need. And as I've said previously, I don't think we can do that unless the governance arrangements actually have teachers as a majority of those arrangements moving forward. And I would agree with what Lauren said previously in terms of the accreditation and regulatory functions, that has to be in a separate body. If there's going to be assurance that some of the issues that you've raised this morning are going to be dealt with fairly and partially and looked at appropriately moving forward.
I know we're going to be picking up on some of those themes shortly with other lines of questions. Graeme, do you want to respond?
Yeah, I just want to come in to agree with my colleagues and whatnot. I think with moving the SQA forward, it's a kind of three steps forward, two steps back, and sometimes they go into vault defence mechanism, and the shutters come down, and they're not really prepared to listen, and it takes a bit of persuading. Another example would be the recent discussion we've had with them about the 2025 diet timetable and when it was going to start 2 days after Easter, and having to persuade them to move that the week later to allow young people to have some time in school so that they're exam ready. So sometimes they go into default mode, and it's trying to move them forward to that. So I think there is three steps forward and two steps back at some point. I think with the history, that needs to be really looked at. And my feeling is that even if the person doing the independent review within the SQA comes up with something, they will still want an independent with the SQA. And maybe that's something they need to go think about, something we're not there to get them. We're trying to make sure we do the best by the young people. And that's at the heart of everything.
Thank you. And finally, Fiona Robinson mentioned this morning the bill creates scaffolding to make the change when she was asked about culture. Does the panel believe the bill will bring the types of improvements in cultural and behavioural change that are expected through the scaffolding that's been described?
I've probably answered this already, Pam, but no, I don't believe that it will provide sufficient structure because of the governance arrangements. So if you look at the membership of the New Qualifications Scotland, you've got a chair, the convener of the Accreditation Committee and the chief executive, so three members. And thereafter, the bill becomes a bit opaque, because we have a reference to between 6 and 10 members, and of that, obviously, one or more being a representative of learners, two or more being a representative of registered teachers, two or more, obviously, from people teaching in the college sector, and one or more of staff. So I, looking at that, I cannot assess how the balance of power within that body is going to be structured. I don't know how many teachers are on it. It could be that teacher voice is again in the minority. And if that is the case, then that structural change, the empowerment that I referred to both in Muir and in the national discussion, won't be coming through. And therefore, you're not going to get that buy-in from the profession to ensure that their interests are being adequately represented in a meaningful way. I think the other thing that's missing from the actual central governance provisions is that it refers to a registered teacher. The EIS has been really clear that that should be a representative function, so we would want to see that those two or more, however many they are, filled by people who are representative of the professional associations, because there is then a proper structure through which policy is formulated democratically, that there is engagement with the profession, and there's a means of consultation. So it can't just be the individual interests of two or more teachers in that panel. It must be a representative voice, and the method through which that can be achieved is through engagement with the professional associations. I'm concerned that the teacher and practitioner interest committee come back later.
We've got lots of questions. You don't feel you have to get everything in when you're responding at the Lawrence.
Thank you. Just in response to your question, I think there's scaffolding potentially insofar as the charters are concerned. I think the concept of charters is a positive one. We've said that in our statement. But it says very little about them. So how will the charter be created, co-created with the profession, with learners and so on? And if you take the higher history example from this year, how would a charter have prevented that? Because I think Graeme said in his response, too little, too late. So there has been a response. how could that have been structured within a charter so that if a significant amount of candidates have an issue with a specific examination paper, how was that dealt with by the system? So a real co-created progressive charter could give some confidence to the system that these kind of issues would be addressed more swiftly, which hasn't been the case with the higher history. As soon as the youngsters got the results, I was getting representation from parents about it, and it's taken some time. We're almost at the October break now for that review to be commissioned, and understand the questions about the independence of that. But I do think there is scaffolding there. I think it's incumbent on all of us as a profession, including the Qualifications Authority, to work collectively across the whole system with all partners in making sure those charters come off paper and they're brought to life and they're meaningful. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just want to say I agree with what my colleagues are saying. I hesitate to use the word scaffolding because that usually leads to an execution, and I hope that that's not going to happen here. But I think the voice of teachers, as Anna said, of young people, and also employers, because in her review of the qualifications and assessment, Lewis Hayward spent a lot of time with the employers, and they are all in favour of moving forward. And they are the ones that use the qualifications, and quite often the qualifications, what is the validity time for these qualifications is quite often only a few months, and so therefore it's important that employers have a say in that as well. I think it's important that the SQA or the Qualifications Scotland don't have a majority. I think Anne said that, and we would agree with that, because in past times when I was on the NQ group during the COVID time, the majority of people on that were SQA internal, and it needs to be a far more external orientated organisation. And finally, I would say on what Pam has asked, the accreditation committee is not strong enough, and really we would back Professor Muir's point that they have to be separate powers, and therefore maybe it is a reason to set up a separate arm's length organisation to do accreditation, or to look at the SCQF partnership framework. But I understand that that would involve legislation as well. But maybe that's what needs to go in there as well.
Thanks, Graham. Can I come to John Mason now, please?
Thanks very much, convener. And maybe to kind of continue this theme. So I was going to ask you about some of the interest committees and the advisory council which are proposing the legislation. I'm not asking about the board. One of my colleagues is going to do that. So if we can leave the board till just after. The interest committees and the advisory council, and I suppose my first question really is, how is this going to be different from what we have at the moment? Because I think there is a similar advisory council at the moment, and maybe I think the EIS is on that. I'm not sure who else. You can tell us, does it have influence at the moment, and do you think there'll be more influence or better influence in the future?
I think the concern of the EIS all throughout this is the nature of these committees is that it is advisory, Mr Mason. And that's something which we have been clear about throughout. Our concern is, so we are involved in the advisory committee at the minute, but clearly that is still an advisory capacity. So there is no mechanism through which we can ensure that teacher voice is adequately heard. And there have been a number...
Well, sorry, can I just press you on that? Saying it's adequately heard. I mean, you don't have to have a majority to be adequately heard, do you?
Well, if
I get heard in this committee, I'm not a majority.
I accept that. I think the issue is we want teachers' voice central to the governance arrangements, and the only way that we can ensure that they were going to be meaningfully taken forward will be if there is a majority. Otherwise, they could be listened to and disregarded, and that's the same in the governance arrangements, but also in the advisory committees.
If there's a majority
committees.
Of teachers, that means that every other group, the learners, the parents, the taxpayers... They're all in a minority. They're effectively excluded then, aren't they?
Well, they're not excluded. No, they too, as I've said before, are listened to. But I think
but that
you
would
also,
be it, just
no,
listened
no,
to.
No, it's not. I think there's a reference to the importance of what teachers do. Now, teachers are obviously advising on the best interests of education, and I think it's going back to something that Stuart said previously, the role of teachers as educators. All teachers in Scotland are educators because they care about the interests of children and young people. So teachers are also advocates of learners in this space, and they have a voice to put forward in that regard as well.
I did pick up your point about the advocates of young people, yeah, but yeah. I mean, surely, if we're going to have a, the two interest committees, they do need to be different. I mean, if the teachers dominate both, that wouldn't be right, would it?
Well, so we would have, I mean, I think the problem is at the minute we don't know. There's no instance that actually teachers are going to dominate either, which is a particular concern, because the bill has been drafted in such a way that it says there can be members on this Teacher and Practitioner Interest Committee who are members of Qualifications Scotland or members of staff of Qualifications Scotland, although they can't be in a majority. So they're in the minority. Mm-hmm. You then have a majority, and of that majority, there must be teachers represented in that. Now, a majority of a majority is usually a minority. Mm-hmm. So I'm not satisfied that there would even be teacher majority on the Teacher and Practitioner Interest Committee, which seems to me to be quite a conundrum, mm-hmm. if that's going to be taking forward the interests of practitioners. So it's unclear at the minute the role that teachers will have on that committee.
Right. I can maybe widen this out as well, but I mean, that leads to the next question is, how much detail do we go into in legislation? And this applies to all legislation, because if you go into too much detail, it ties everybody's hands for the next 20 years. Or should there be guidance as well or something?
I think there should be. The way it's drafted at the minute is really opaque. If we're talking about majorities of majorities, that's not giving anybody any certainty as to what there should be. There can be clear legislative provisions drafted to say, for example, there should be a teacher majority on the Teacher and Practitioner Interest Committee, because that is the committee where their voice should be heard. Mm-hmm. So I would suggest that there should be greater clarity in the drafting of the provisions, and that we have certainty, and that it's not left to a fluctuation where the interests of teachers on this important committee could be changed at a whim.
Okay,
because
that's helpful.
It's
Thanks.
Not in
Can
legislation.
I'll just move on to Mr. Hunter. Is your view the same, do you think, on the interest committees especially?
I would concur wholeheartedly with what Anne has actually said. I think the bottom line is here, and I come back to a point I made earlier, teachers are professionals. We have our professional judgment. If you have a teacher committee, then really what you're looking at is what the professional is doing, both in the classroom and also within the school environment and the education environment. A very simple analogy, would you outweigh a doctor's committee? We need to be respected as professionals.
Mm-hmm. Although they stopped doctors running hospitals some time ago, yeah, because that was not working.
But I'm talking about the professional judgment that a teacher has within the classroom and the way that education moves forward. I think there is a difference. Okay.
Okay. Do either the other two want to come in about these interest committees in particular?
My only point would be, if I may, that yeah, the Teacher and Practitioner Committee should obviously have lots of teachers and practitioners on it, and the Learner Interest Committee should have learners on it. My point would be they must be representative of the whole of Scotland, and I do think sometimes in some of the governance structures we've had previously, there could be quite a central belt dominance, which can concern myself and colleagues in other parts of the country. So I think there should be good representation from the whole of Scotland to represent the country that the system is set up to serve.
And the same for the Advisory Council?
Same for the Advisory Council.
Mr. Hutton?
I would agree with what my colleague Lillian has said here. I think it's got to be representative. And I'm worried about we're hooked on numbers here, but I think with the Advisory Council, that has to reflect also employers, colleges and whatnot, and yes, other interested parties, because there has to be a representative right across the board. Education is not just about teachers. They play a huge and really important part, but there are other aspects as well with the stakeholder. But I would also say, yes, with the special interest groups, as it were, with these different small committees, then they have to be representative of teachers, of young people. And the young people one is very difficult, because we've got to make sure that they are ready to do that, that they're able to contribute in a positive way, and therefore linking up with the Scottish Youth Parliament might be an idea of moving that forward as well, because they are very very able to do them and defend the interests of young people.
Okay, that's very helpful. I'll leave it at that, Convener.
Thank you, Mr Mason. George Adam now, please. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. It's not often we've heard John Mason admit he's a minority's minority. You know, so it's just a wee bit of light banter before we start there. But moving on to the more serious part of the bill itself is the fact we've heard much about the relationship between SQA currently and the profession itself,
and there's a lack of trust there between both, although Lawrence has already stated that things are getting better. I'm forever the optimist and forever hopeful that we can make things better. So what do we need to do to make these changes? How can that trust be regained with the new qualifications body?
Yeah, I think one of the most significant issues that teachers in the secondary sector and to some degree in the colleges is the failure of SQA to listen to the concerns of teachers when it comes to the dropping in of additional workload at any time in the academic year. We have repeatedly told them, I know our colleagues in EIS and the NASUWT have raised these same issues with the SQA for more than a few years now. The reality is that what happens right now is that in schools, courses have already started. They started before the summer. So you have exam courses taking place right now. And then what will happen is the SQA will drop in changes, additional work that needs to be done, amendments that need to be made, and that will happen in this term, sometimes in October term. Now, by that time, some of the units have been taught, which means that those units now have to be abandoned or you have to start going over the assessments again. We have repeatedly said to them, schools have working time agreements. It is part of the SNCT. Those decisions are often made about the workload of teachers before the summer break. We have asked SQA on numerous occasions to actually try and align themselves. If there are changes, then they have to wait, because teachers are already teaching the course. In addition to that, there is also a hierarchy of subjects. So if you're English or maths or the sciences, you tend to be first in line to get any of the significant updates that are required. If you're in a subject like RME, you get them in November or December when you're about to start prelims. That's when you get changes. So if we're actually looking at the structures, what we have to say is that the SQA must be aligned with the school education system in Scotland. That's a partner. That's not a stakeholder. That's a partner. And that's something that really needs to be listened to. And until SQA or Qualification Scotland can demonstrate that they can work with the teachers in partnership, then I'm afraid trust will be hard to continue to develop. Thank you.
Graham first and then Anne. Anne, there we go.
Thank you. I think, you know, we've alluded in our written evidence, Mr Adam, to the fact that, you know, we would much rather see the governance arrangements change around something akin to a more robust system, similar to the GTCS operations in terms of governance arrangements, or for the bill to be amended to ensure that there is that majority representation and membership of SQA. But I think Stuart raises a really important point, that governance then needs to be developed and made manifest through the actions of the new qualifications agency, by being a listening body, by being responsive to workload. Many of our members tell us that the issues around the qualifications are a major driver of workload, so we need to see that being addressed, and a much more responsive qualifications agency to the needs of the profession as well.
Yeah, I would say there's four things, the four C's. So first of all, there needs to be far more consultation from the SQA about where the assessment procedures are going. There has to be far more collaboration, particularly with Education Scotland, because we can't have the situation where the assessment tail is wagging the dog. I think there needs to be better communication, and I think the point that John Booth has made a big difference in SQA to communication. Usually you would get a communication school on a Friday about 5 to 6 when everybody had gone home. So it's important that there's better communication from SQA. And finally, the fourth is about co-creation. This was an SQA word, and I think it started off, and I think that is what we're really having to move forward, that we co-create together through all the different partners, through and interested parties, teachers, pupils, employers, Education Scotland, SCQF in particular, and I come back to that partnership, which I think is absolutely crucial for moving the reform process forward and working together. And so it would be a better way of doing things through those four things.
No, I would just associate myself with the comments of my colleagues. Thanks.
Okay, just to follow on, I've got a fair idea of what answer I'm going to get here, but I'll ask the question anyway. How do you believe the proposed makeup of the Board of Qualification Scotland should be, in your opinion?
Who's going first? Anyone? Anne? Because you've already sort
I've
of started
already I suppose I've already answered that question. You know, there's a mechanism through which we can... If you look to the model of GTCS, there are a number of educational partners, stakeholders on that board, but the majority is teacher representation. Mm. So something similar to that would be what we have proposed as a robust governance process in terms of the membership of the new Qualifications Scotland. If that model were not adopted, then the current provisions in the bill could be, as I say, adjusted to ensure that there is a majority of teacher representation.
Lawrence.
So I think it's important that there's a board round about the new Qualifications Scotland body that has broad representation from a range of different backgrounds. I do think teachers need to be represented, but I also think employers, local authorities need to be there. We spend a lot of our resource on supporting our schools through the qualifications process. I think it's good to have lay members there as well, who bring something really unique from their own backgrounds and from their roles in society. I think it's good to have broader employers there. People with a business background and so on, who really have a vested interest in the qualification system. So I think it needs to be broad and balanced, and again, representative of Scotland as a whole. Thank you.
The end of that, because one of the things we've heard is the fact that from the evidence last week and earlier on was the fact that it's a broad landscape. Like there's so many players. Oh, I don't doubt for a minute teachers are an extremely important part of that. But I'm just saying there are so many other kind of people who are involved and stakeholders there as well. So, you know, there'll always be someone, you know, sitting there saying we should have representation on said board because of X, Y and Z. So how do you see as kind of plan? Because, Lawrence, you've kind of made this come and may go down this route because you've said from a local authority mm-hmm. point of view. And I get that because I used to be a councillor, so I understand that from that perspective. So, you know, how do you find a way to... You'll not keep everybody happy all the time, but how do you find the board to get it that way so people feel it is representative of all those involved in education in Scotland?
Graham, you do that by consultation and about getting people around the table and not imposing it and co-creating. How do we move this forward? How do we get an advisory board that will actually be more than just advise, will actually direct how the Qualifications Scotland will go? And the wider you make that and the greater the number in it, then the more variety of views. I think that's what Lawrence is saying, is that there has to be a variety of views there. And if you hold to say this association has to have representative but that one doesn't because it's a bigger one, or that's a bigger one, or that, or it's a different aspect, that's not the way, that's not the route to go down. It's about who can contribute a valid interest for young, or about young people, and how we ensure that they get the best deal possible through the Qualifications Association, like Qualifications Authority.
It's okay. Well, yes, tripping up was like me earlier.
Better than sausage, like me. Anne.
Thank you. I think the distinction is maybe between the board and the advisory board. Mm-hmm. So you've got membership. So the membership of the new Qualifications Scotland should be quite small, I would say, as it, you know, I think it could be up to what 13 members is currently drafted, and it's vital that we've got teachers, we've got learners' interest in that. Those are key if we're going to adhere to Muir and to the other OECD reports. So I think there's a distinction between who's in the membership of that board. I also think it is important that staff are represented, the new Qualifications Scotland staff are represented in that space, because, you know, we don't want to, they do a fantastic job across the piece, and it's we want to make sure that they have a body. So there's the membership, and then distinct, I think, you've got the advisory committee, and that's where maybe advisory committees can perhaps inform that wider stakeholder engagement and partner engagement moving forward.
You okay?
I'm fine.
I was just sure, are you okay with this? Would you want to add?
Yeah, I would just agree wholeheartedly with what's been said.
Super, thank you. Evelyn Tweed, over to yourself now.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. I'd like to ask the panel if the bill ensures that the Inspectorate is sufficiently independent from Scottish ministers, and if I can maybe pose that to Anne first.
I don't think it's sufficiently independent from ministers. I should probably preface this by saying we would obviously have liked to have seen a different model rather than the inspection model that we have in the bill. But I can come back to that if we want to discuss that further in another question. We would much rather have seen resources being developed to support and development of teachers and appropriated a quality assurance process rather than what we've got. But in terms of what we have, if we have to have an inspection function, we welcome that it was to be independent. That was a recommendation from Professor Muir, that be independent of ministerial control. And as currently drafted in the bill, I don't think it provides that reassurance. There are a number of functions, and I think we've outlined that in our written evidence, where ministers have control. Ministers can appoint or can recommend for appointment other inspectors. They can direct the chief inspector to inspect establishments and so on. So there's a whole range of functions where we still see that ministerial control, and we would much rather see a truly independent inspectorate that is reporting directly to the Scottish Parliament.
Lawrence.
Yeah, I agree that the independence of a new Chief Inspector of Education must be completely independent and impartial. And it's interesting to note that over the past few years, we've seen some fantastic reports published in this country, the Muir report, the OECD report, the Stobart report, the Hayward report, and so on. International Council of Education Advisors writing some excellent reports on state of the nation education within Scotland. That, to me, would suggest that the inspectorate has not been doing that job adequately or appropriately over the past decade or so. And we used to rely hugely as a profession on the Improving Scottish Education series, which gave that fantastic State of the Nation overview of education derived from what HMI were seeing in our schools. We used to have really good curricular reports into the state of different curricular areas and what effective learning and teaching was looking like in different subject areas. We haven't seen any of that for a long time. So something has been going wrong, and I think I would associate myself with Anne's comments that the new Chief Inspector and Inspectorate must be absolutely independent to allow them to tell it as it is, if you like, to speak truth unto power when it comes to the state of Scottish education and what needs to change. Thank you.
Graham and then Stuart.
Yeah, I would totally agree with my colleagues. I say that we believe that the Chief Inspector has to be totally independent, but has to be able to be accountable to Parliament. That will be a very powerful job, and I think there has to be some accountability in the Parliament. Education has become a real political football over the last 10 years, and I think by taking it out of hands of one of the government, of the Scottish Government, and putting it in the hands of Parliament, wait a minute, that's actually taken from one set of politicians to giving it to all the politicians, but I think that becomes a better cooperation, that co-creation idea of how we move Scottish education forward. So I think that there has to be an accountability of the inspector. We would also welcome far more involvement of associate assessors in the inspection process. I'm glad to. I tend to agree with Anne about inspection being a kind of old-fashioned term. They were using the word scrutiny, and I think that is totally now gone out, thank goodness. But I think the more you get practicing teachers and leaders in schools being part of the inspection process, you move to a far better situation of self-improvement, and therefore. I know that there's plans at the moment. Associate assessors are really deputies or mainly head teachers, but we would welcome it being faculty heads as well, because they're the ones who really run the departments and support the teachers in the classroom to deliver and improve things.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. I would agree with everything again that our colleagues have actually said here. The only addition to that for me and for the SSTA as a whole. Why independent, completely independent from government? At the end of the day, an inspectorate is meant to be, the whole purpose of an inspectorate is to support the schools, the local authorities and the teaching staff. If it's completely independent, it's more empowered to actually do that rather than following key drivers. For example, schools are driven, are exam-driven, data-driven, and you find a lot of the reporting systems and the workload are based on that. An independent inspectorate would be looking at how they can support the schools to achieve the outcomes that they're looking for, rather than actually penalising them, which can be seen through league tables. Thank you.
And just to follow up on that, to what degree should a future independent chief inspector be able to determine the purpose and the approach to inspections?
I think they should have that ability to determine the approach to inspection. However, it should be done, again, we've used the word a lot today, in co-creation with the wider education community. So if you look at what's happening just now, I'll give a very live example. Currently, all local authorities in Scotland are being inspected. There's a thematic inspection being looked at how well we are supporting schools and our local authorities. So this was announced just before the summer break and is taking place throughout September and October. It will be followed with a national report. Whereas certainly within ADES, we are much more of the view that we can take a different approach to supporting improvement from within the system. So local authorities and our staff, including school staff, working closely with Education Scotland, HMI, in developing more of a validated self-evaluation model, such as the collaborative improvement work that we've led over the last few years, which has led to our next phase of work, which is looking at how good is our education authority. So I think there's a more progressive approach we can take rather than what seems to be just now from these thematic reviews, quite a top-down model of accountability being imposed again. Thank you.
Anne first, and
oh no, you went, I went first last time. No, on you go.
I agree with what Lawrence has said, and I think it's important that there is a purpose to inspection, and it's not just about finding out what's wrong, it's about finding what the good things as well. And one of the things that has not been passed on under the inspectorate in the past is the huge examples of top quality practice that are going on in schools across Scotland. The emphasis seems to be sometimes within the inspection on what's gone wrong, what needs to improve. There's a huge amount of really super stuff going on in Scotland schools that we should be immensely proud of. And the OECD actually pointed that out. If you look at the wellbeing aspects and various other things of them, we need to make sure we share that good practice as well. And we need to make sure that the schools that aren't finding that school that good practice, where we don't find that school good practice, are helped and supported by having a team around the school. Too often in the past, schools have been found to be lacking and have been left to get on with it. And then the inspectors will come back. We'll come back in 6 months. We'll come back in a year. And the school has not really had the chance or the facilities or the capacity or the ability to improve on its own, and even the local authority may not be able to go. So that we think there needs to be a kind of team around the school that will help and support and come in from other, and that's where maybe Education Scotland, the reformed Education Scotland, who I have to say are not mentioned at all in this bill, well, where are they going? And the Qualifications Authority, SCQF, all the different partners could come in together and support a school which is struggling. So that's the purpose is to improve schools, not to just do them down.
What I would add to that, I know it's becoming a bit of an echo chamber, but I agree with everything that's been said. But something that does need to be added to that, have any of members sitting here right now ever been in a school a few days before a school inspection? Because I'll tell you, you go into any school in Scotland that's about to be inspected and you will see staff absolutely exhausted because they are running like rats in a run, trying to get all of the evidence that they need in order to meet the standards for the inspectorate. And that doesn't matter whether it's classroom teachers, it's right through the entire school, the school leadership, everybody. They are terrified. The minute you mention inspection, the staff go, oh no. They are terrified because it comes on top of everything. Hence the reason why we would say that the inspectorate, when it comes to advisory bodies, etc., etc., we need to change the culture. The culture means it has to be supportive. Our colleagues have actually highlighted here, every school in Scotland, there is some amazing work going on with our children and the staff. It's incredible what they do. Schools are not about exam results. They are about every single child in that classroom and trying to make life better for them. And that often gets lost in league tables. I'm sorry to repeat that one again. Thank you.
Anne,
thanks. Thanks very much. Should the Chief Inspector have that the function? I think the original question to make the determine what the inspections look like. I think that comes back to governance as well, and I think Lawrence has alluded to it in terms of the collaboration. And I think we need to see much more change, as my colleagues have outlined. We have an antiquated system of inspection that is top down. It's driven by top down accountability targets. It drives pressure on staff. It impacts on staff health and wellbeing. And I would question the extent to which it really contributes to advancing educational purposes at this stage. If the Chief Inspector is looking at this, we would very much hope, as was highlighted in Muir and the Scottish Government response, that there would be a much more collaborative approach, signalling empowerment with a strong focus on self-evaluation and teacher voice. But it comes back to that governance arrangement, and is currently stipulated in the bill, the only thing in terms of governance that we can see is the advisory council, and I don't think that goes far enough to give us the assurance that the changes that we need to see in terms of culture will be effective, because what we don't want to see is that being dependent on one person's views. It can't just change if there's a new chief inspector. There needs to be governance arrangements in place to ensure that there is truly an empowered, collaborative approach to what we would see would be would like to see a much more co-created, that word's been used a lot in this session, but a much more co-created approach to support and development rather than inspection.
Graham.
Yeah, I just wanted to add one more thing along those lines, is that the gradings that come with the quality indicators do not help. People focus unduly on whether the school is excellent, very good, good and satisfactory. And it's not about that. And a school can be branded wrongly for not having good attainment when so many other things are going right in that school. I can speak from personal experience there. We need to have a narrative of where the school is at, how it got there, and how it can move on. That's how we improve schools in Scotland, not by branding. I work very closely with ASCO, which is our sister union in England, and they've been following the Ofsted change there with one word. We're not as bad as that, but we've had the same impact sometimes by these gradings in the past, and therefore we feel very strongly that the gradings have to go, the scores and the doors have to go, and have a narrative of where the school is, how it's got there, as I say, and how do we move on? And that's where that team around the school comes in.
Bill Kidd, I know you want to pick up on that thread, don't you?
Yes, please. Yes, thanks, convener. It's very important, as has been said, that schools are not held, and held up to the wall and sort of just vilified because somebody decides that something's not right or something like that. Local authorities, obviously, in overarching in terms of every school, they have local authorities above them, and their contribution to how education is delivered does need to be evaluated also. Because I can see what you're saying about let's not just pin people to the wall and say you're not doing it right or you're doing it wrong or whatever sort of thing, because there's more to it than an immediate inspection would suggest. But how do you communicate to the learners, their parents or carers, and in fact to the voters in local authority areas, how do you get out the performance of the school once you've actually overcome the difficulties that we have with the present inspection regime? How do you get that out to let people know how the school's improving and so on?
I mean, if I can come in first, thanks for the question. I mean, certainly, I think that's round about your approach to standards and quality reporting. So I would expect all local authorities to have an approach to standards and quality reporting across all their establishments, so that there was a consistency in terms of what schools were telling their parents, their communities about the performance of that school, and, you know, outlining what their priorities for improvement are, what their successes have been, and so on and so forth. And then that needs to be quality assured within the local authority, so there's somebody checking that what's going out is actually factual, can be backed up with evidence and data and so on.
Thanks.
I think it's come back to the national discussion, and I think this is part of the problem. We're looking at all of these reforms in isolation. But if we go back to the national discussion, what Ken Muir asked for that discussion to lead was a consensual vision. And the national discussion gave that consensual vision of holistic development of children underpinned by social justice, equity, equality and diversity, where we're meeting the needs of all learners, but we're doing it in an empowered system. And I think we come back to empowerment. We throw that word around, but very rarely do we actually unpick what it means. And that means involving the children, the young people, the families, the whole community within which that school is placed, in the journey of that school and the journey of those learners. And I think we need to get away from top-down performativity targets where we're constantly measuring and measuring and measuring and actually looking to realigning our resources to providing support and development at a local level, which is going to enable collaborative engagement across the piece so that the community is aware of how good that school is. They will engage with them. There can be other reporting mechanisms, but it's the cultural change, I think I would say, Mr. Kidd, that we need to move forward in if we're ever going to achieve that consensual vision about what curriculum for excellence is, and if we're going to deliver meaningful outcomes for children and young people, but also meaningful and supportive conditions for which our teachers are working in the present day without undue stress as well.
Yeah, I understand. And that's been very helpful, actually. So on the back of that, then, the proposed advisory council, which we've talked about and has been proposed, it was mentioned about teachers' representation, etc., and people who is represented on such an advisory council. That would it not help to actually shape the kind of approach that's taken to inspections? And what's your view in terms of how this council should be set up and how it should then operate once it's established? If it should be established, actually, you might not think.
So, I mean, I think it should be established because it's something that is lacking at present, and I think it's important, again, and I've said it before, that it's fully representative of the establishments and the bodies that are inspected. So, yes, schools are inspected, but so are early learning and childcare settings, so is community learning and development, and so on and so forth. So it's vital to me that all those key people, the people who've got a stake in the game, who are inspected, if you like, and I include employers in that, as local authorities currently going through these thematic inspections, have a voice in how the system evolves and how it improves, and again, how it's co-created to be fit for purpose in the 21st century. Thanks.
Thank you. And Graham?
I would agree with that in many ways. I think there has to be an advisory. HMIE have been doing their own thing, as it were, for a long, long while. And although we want it to be independent from government, we still need some advice about how we move it forward. And that, again, let's come back to that, the four C's I mentioned earlier, is about consultation and about working together in order to take things forward. And I think also in reporting back, at the moment, we either have a letter to the school and we have the SIF, which is the school's inspection findings. And it's a far more in-depth report, which was actually originally intended to be for school use only. But through Freedom of Information Act, it usually has to be released as well. And maybe it's something in between that will tell the story of where the school is, how it's moved on, and what support it's getting from the local authorities. Yeah. And maybe there's also needs, I know my colleagues in AHDS would say, it's the local authorities that need to be inspected and taken into consideration how they support all the different schools in their areas. Because in one local authority, you may get schools at different ends of the spectrum, from high SIMD to low SMD, and some in the middle, which are completely comprehensive. But each school is different, and that's the problem. One size does not fit all, and what goes on in one school may not be transplanted into another school and be successful there. So where does the local authority come in that? How does it support it? And how does it work quite often with a cluster of secondary schools plus their primary schools? And looking at that from a different... So there are different angles that we could look at, apart from the traditional, we're going in to see this one school in isolation, okay, and we're going to report on it and leave it there and go away.
OK. Anne?
Yeah. See, the advisory council, it's a start. It doesn't go as far enough as you'll have seen from our written report. We've kind of advocated that there's more of a board approach in terms of the inspectorate to be able to kind of influence the governance arrangements more directly rather than just being merely advisory. And I think our concern at the minute is, as currently drafted, the bill merely provides that the chief inspector will endeavour to ensure that the advisory council is representative of those to whom will be affected by the inspections. So the bill doesn't provide great clarity in relation to who will be on that council. And I agree that it does have to be representative. And obviously we would want to see teachers' voice as a key part of that. But we would say that there should be, and a move to a much more collaborative, self-evaluative approach, we would say advocate for a board rather than an advisory council as well.
Sensible. And Stuart?
Again, I would concur with everything that has been said. Again, the only addition, and to some extent I know I'm repeating this, the advisory board has the potential, massive potential, to flag up everything that's good that's going on in schools. Yeah. Because our education system in the senior phase, in the secondary phase, is exam-driven. It's all about results. And so when you actually look at those exam results, how many of those kids don't actually end up sitting exams? How many of those kids who have actually achieved massively, massively, way beyond their potential, but don't get an exam result? Mm. The advisory board would be, I believe, a key function in actually highlighting the successes of the idea, the principle of GERFEC, getting it right for every child. That is the raison d'etre of education in Scotland. We need to get it right for every child. An advisory board, if following through on what Anne has already highlighted quite eloquently, we have massive potential here to help the education or the educators to get it right for every child.
Okay, thank you. And from that, then, I'm presuming that the panel is actually proposing that it would be the right, correct way forward if we didn't just hear when somebody's done something wrong, we actually hear about all the things that have been done well and actually push them out and raise people's sort of belief and expectations of schools and what they deliver.
Totally agree with that. Yeah. I think that's what the Hayward proposals actually encapsulated about the Scottish Diploma of Achievement. But it's not just about the academic. It's about all the other things that young people do. And I know there's a question of equity there, but that can be solved because actually this was brought forward through the Hayward recommendations as a way of ensuring that those that are not in SIMD 9 and 10, they actually had something that they could show for what they've done. If they were a carer, if they had a part-time job, they maybe didn't get a National 5, but they had all these other skills and experiences which are just as relevant, particularly for employers. And Stuart's absolutely right. There are 20% of our young people who leave school without a National 5, one National 5. That is one of the benchmarks, one of the metrics that we use in Scotland. These metrics are wrong. They do not represent exactly how much young people do achieve. And that's because National 4 is not highly regarded. And one of the reasons that we wanted to see exams being taken out of National 5 was to raise the standard of National 5 and make it highly regarded so that these young people who leave school without this first watermark on the wall, as it were, of one national flag can actually be seen to have achieved something. And the SDA, which Louise Hayward proposed, starts that off. We're making baby steps towards it, and I mean baby steps, but that has to catch on at pace so that we can actually see what our young people... The OECD, if you focus on these metrics, particularly for reading literacy and numeracy, and I'm not doing them down because I think they are important, I said, but there's so much else in Scotland that's going on that young people do benefit from. And there's a whole lot of schools where their attainment maybe is not up there amongst, you know, five plus, you know, level six, because I'm not going to call it hires anymore, it's level six. There's so much else going on there for our young people. And if we want the economic benefits of us to improve in this country, then we have to look at them as well and make sure that they get recognition and are valued for what they've done.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Can I go back just a little bit, if you don't mind? And I want to talk about the actual mechanism of evaluation, I suppose. And we've heard from Stuart around the fear and the panic in the establishments when they're notified. But we also heard from Graham and a bit from Lawrence about the importance that a local authority plays in that performance of that school. So how should schools and local authorities' performance be evaluated? How do you think it should be evaluated?
So I think what is critical is the inspection agency and the local authorities and the work together to bring together their skills, their expertise, their knowledge to look at the key indicators that matter. So that obviously a huge one will be about outcomes for learners. So how are we improving outcomes for learners in local authority A, B or C? How good is our leadership and direction and vision for education in local authority A, B and C? And together, you know, lay out our stall as to where we think we're at and where we think we can improve based on evidence, based on data and so on. So it should be much less top down from the inspectorate, more consensual as a system. That's, I think, the approach that we need to be taking in future. And it must also be cognizant of context, because I think context is really, really important. And Graham alluded to that, and we were chatting about this earlier actually today, that you may have a school in one part of the country, in SIMD Area 5, very, very different in terms of its local context to SIMD 5 and another local authority area, just because of job patterns, geography, whatever it might be. The national standard is the national standard. We appreciate that, but context is unique to individual areas. And, you know, there are parts of the country, including my own area, where we really struggle to recruit teachers into certain sectors, and very little cognizance is taken of that during inspection, which is even more stressful for staff, because the national standard is the national standard and we get that, but that context must be understood by all.
That's some helpful examples given there. Does anyone else want to comment on that? Graham and then Stuart.
I would concur with what Lawrence said there, and I think it's important that we have a standard for what we expect in the schools. And at the moment we use Higios, which is how good is our school, and it's edition 4 at the moment. But maybe that needs to be looked, that definitely needs to be looked at. But whether it's just replaced or refurbished, or whether we look at a totally different way of evaluating schools and what that quality assurances, quality indicators are. The quality indicator, there's far too many of them, and yet there's 30, I think. And but the HMI only focus really on 4 or 2, depending on what the length of the inspection is. So it's important that we look at what is important in schools. What do we value? And I come back to the what do we value, rather than what the metrics are linked to the National Improvement Framework. But what do we value? What is the context of that school? Because I was head teacher of one school in Dundee. I was a senior deputy in another school in Dundee, just 2 miles away. They were chalk and cheese. And yet what was going on in both schools was valuable and relevant to these young people in that school. They were different, but they were still more in tune with what these young people needed and to help them support.
Okay, thank you, Graham. Stuart?
Yeah, I think there's an interesting model already takes place across a lot of local authorities. And that's where you have the schools doing a local self-evaluation of where they are. And I think that's really, really important. When it's done properly, it's usually done in conjunction with the local authority employer. It's often arranged through the LNCT meetings at local level, and there are agreed parameters. As Graham has already highlighted, it's usually the Hagios factors, indicators that are used as part of that. But I'll tell you what's really positive about it, is that when it's done on a voluntary basis, it's amazing how everyone buys into it and they actually all work together. Then what you can do as a basis for that, rather than doubling and tripling the amount of work that's involved, the fact that that's taken place, then that's something that can then be handed to any inspectorate to turn around and say, this was actually completed, you know, this last academic year. These were the outcomes that we achieved. That then actually allows the inspector to look at other indicators without going into a massive inspection that's hugely disruptive and stressful, because staff are already doing that in local authorities. As far as I'm aware, every local authority in Scotland actually will inspect the schools. So why are we having double, triple inspections when local authorities are already doing it?
Thank you, Stuart. Have you got anything additional to add?
Yeah, I mean, I think Stuart's highlighted a point there. There is I think this whirlwind of top-down accountability is creating additional workload with those mini inspections that that are happening before the inspection processes, which is, again, a driver of workload for members. As I've indicated previously, I think we would much rather see, you know, a complete review of the inspection process, something that's co-created with the profession and that is much more akin to the Finland model. I think Professor Priestley spoke about that last week, something that is much more driven with resources towards support and towards development rather than top-down accountability.
Thank you very much for that. Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. There's obviously a huge amount of reform work going on, and the bill's only part of that, and arguably most of the reform that government is looking at actually sits outside of legislation. Does the panel believe we're undertaking this in the right order? Should we start with the bill and then move on to other non-legislative reform work, or would you have rather seen something different? And I might come to Anne first, because you touched on all the other reform work that's going on earlier on.
It's a difficult one to answer succinctly. I think we were clear, and our members have been clear, that we needed to see reform of the Qualifications Agency, and we needed to see that urgently. We raised concerns when there was a delay about that last year, so we welcome that there is action being taken to advance that. Equally, we welcome that there's an action taken in relation to inspections. So I think we have to start somewhere, and I think this structural reform is actually quite a good place to start in terms of moving us forward. However, I can't, you know, we can't get away from the fact that there is much, much more work to do in terms of that cultural change that we've referred to, but also, more importantly, in achieving that vision of education that we spoke about, and we've got a consensual at the minute. We've spent a lot of time over the last year with numerous reviews, and if you put all the jigsaw pieces together, we've got a consensual vision and a pathway for where we can go to better meet the needs of children and young people in Scotland and ensure that we're developing them holistically, and that we are celebrating not only attainment but achievement, so that everybody, as colleagues have referenced, is leaving school celebrating the advancements that they've made in education. So we've got a huge way to go with that. I think the bill is a start. Obviously, we had the announcement by the Cabinet Secretary last week in terms of Hayward, and whilst we welcomed the fact that she signalled the need for culture change and for the teaching to be profession to be centre of reform, we are and also acknowledged that there was a need to move away from some exams. We're concerned that we're not moving faster in terms of giving that parity between the academic and vocational qualifications, that we're not moving away from the two-term dash that we all know, and that we're still being attainment-driven. And I think that's the culture change that we need to alter if we're going to have curriculum for excellence, which has been lauded through all of these reports, actually leading to a meaningful end in the senior phase for a huge number of children and young people, and we so desperately want to ensure that we are developing all of the four capacities, so not just successful learners. We want confident individuals, responsible citizens, to be coming out at the other end of this.
Lawrence.
Yeah, Anne's right, we need to start somewhere, and this is clearly where we're starting. But what I would say is there's very little said about the remainder of Education Scotland once the inspectorate leaves, and for me that's really, really crucial. And Graham and I were chatting earlier about what we wish we'd known 20 years ago in the early days of Curriculum for Excellence, and one of the big things would have been about the need to build in that curriculum review cycle, which is really going to be essential in ensuring that we future-proof the curriculum and we're not in the same position in another 10 or 20 years' time. That is critical. And interestingly, I was here a few years ago talking about regional improvement collaboratives, and whilst they weren't perfect, local authorities did come together to share resources, to look at issues where they had shared concerns and so on. And it was disappointing to see that announcement last year that there'd be a shift away from regional working to a more centralised national model. And that does give me some concern, just given the context of our different parts of the country. And collaboration is key, as we've said several times throughout today's meeting. But I would also associate myself with Anne's comments on Hayward. I think that was one of the potentially one of the most exciting changes that we would have seen for a long time. Stuart spoke about getting it right for every child and every learner, and clearly we haven't been doing that because of the number of young people for whom the senior phase has not been working. And I don't think Hayward is a pick and mix approach. I think it's a total approach to shifting the system once and for all. The pandemic, if it taught us anything, was that we had an outdated model of assessing young people in the senior phase, not fit for purpose. And the 21st century is certainly not pandemic-proof, as we learned to our cost. So this gave us a real opportunity. So I think there are other areas that we need to be taking a much closer look at as an education system. Thanks.
Thanks. Sorry.
No, I was just going to say, I concur with my colleagues to a great extent. We are where we are. The time that's taken from all these reports coming in to get baby steps forward has been frustrating, to say the least. And I think we are in SLS a wee bit disappointed about how far. I would disagree with Anne about the word vision, because I don't think there's a complete vision of where Scottish education is going at the moment. I think there's too many jigsaw pieces, and I don't know how they all fit in, because this bill only deals with the Qualifications Authority and with the inspectorate. It doesn't mention Education Scotland, and also the Centre for Teaching Excellence, the SCQF partnership, the GTCS. Where do they all fit in together? Because they all have to interlink, and they're all partners in taking forward things for our young people. So I think that vision hopefully will come shortly. I think the Cabinet Secretary is going to issue that in November. But I think the bill is just a starting point, and the baby steps are there. Hayward, to our mind in SLS, was an absolutely golden opportunity to move our education system forward. Our education system at the moment really is based on when the highers were and the lowers were introduced in 1888. It's a 19th century system. It's had bits bolted onto it, other bits bolted on top of those bits, and bits have rusted, and bits are, and it's creaking. And we needed to take, maybe not a big bang approach, but certainly a fundamental review, which is what Louise Hayward did, to take forward a system suitable for the 21st century. We're a quarter of the way through the 21st century, and we're not, as we've said earlier, really delivering for all our young people and for the country.
Could I come back to you then, Graham, on that point of those jigsaw pieces? Uh-huh. What are the dangers of potentially having to take a hammer to those jigsaw pieces to make them fit in that context of reform, rather than that whole scale review to make sure that everything sits together neatly, like Hayward might have been?
I think that is a danger. Maybe I wouldn't be using a hammer to put jigsaw, but I would be using a jigsaw to cut bits off. But it's where do they all fit together? Because there is an overlap with Centre for Teaching Excellence, looking at how doing research into what is good pedagogy, but what is the good practice that HMI are already seeing in schools, and how do they share that? I mentioned that earlier. Mm. How does Education Scotland come into that? Because they do a fantastic job of supporting
professional learning and improving learning and teaching right across the country. And that, all these things, there are overlaps, and there really shouldn't be, because we're in a situation of financial constraint and we can't really have doubling up. We have to make sure that everything fits together. So maybe not a hammer, but certainly it needs to be a complete picture, bigger picture, of how does everything fit together. And at the moment, I'm not convinced that that is the case.
That's great. Thanks.
Could I ask what you think the new Education Scotland should focus on to ensure that it's contributing effectively to the high quality learning and teaching in schools?
Lawrence. Yep. So I think it should continue the focus that it started already on supporting the system with the curriculum review cycle, which is going to be essential, I think, as I mentioned in my earlier response. And also it has to play a key role in the professional learning of teachers and practitioners across the system. So continuing to support middle leadership programmes, the inter-headship programme, which we are all partners in round this table. So I think it needs to continue along those lines.
Thank you. I'm just going to go along the line, if that's okay. Graham?
I would agree with that. I think there's immense work being done on the professional learning front, particularly with inter-headship and into middle management. I also think that the curriculum review cycle, as Lawrence has said, is actually well overdue, and it was one of the OECD recommendations about where are we with each area of the curriculum. And to start off with maths and then English and move right through all the curriculum areas is a very sensible thing to do, but to do it in a cycle over the next 10 years and come back to it.
Thanks, Graham. Anne?
We would like to see much more support from Education Scotland for classroom teachers. We've highlighted in our response that teachers, or in previous responses to reviews, that teachers felt that when Learning and Teaching Scotland was disbanded and support from local authorities in relation to particular areas, that was a huge miss for teachers. And we'd like to see the kind of co-creation or much more advice coming out in terms of curriculum for classroom teachers and the production of resources that could be adapted and support them, particularly in a number of difficult areas where they're looking for sensitive responses around RSHP relationships and health practices. So I think we would like to see much more advice coming out in terms of support, direct support for the classroom teachers. I agree with what my colleague said in terms of the curriculum review cycles. We think that's a really important piece of work, and we're delighted to see that there has been a commitment to involve classroom teachers. I think the concern at the minute is that teachers are not being released to engage in these practices as readily as we can. We've heard about the maths review that took place. We raised a number of concerns about the fact that took place over the summer holidays. So the teachers that were engaging in that process were giving up their holidays to go and become involved in it. So if we are really committed to curriculum review cycle and we want the voice of teachers to be at the centre of that, this needs to be matched by resources to allow teachers to engage in that meaningfully.
Thank you, Anne, for that. Stuart?
Anne stole my thunder. And
You can always repeat it loud.
What I would actually say is teachers are at the heart of education. They're the ones in the classroom. Education Scotland, and did mention and reference LTS Scotland, where you had resources and materials which were given to the various curricula leaders and classroom teachers in the subject specialism. In the secondary sector, it is subject specialism. Over the last 20 years, 25 years now, with teachers in the 20th century, 21st century, etc., we have seen generic CPD, almost gone completely is the CPD on subject specialism, which has a direct impact on the curriculum delivery. So therefore the SSTA and our members are pretty unanimous on this. That Education Scotland should get back to the day job of actually delivering for the classroom teachers and for schools in general in developing and supporting the curriculum. Thank you.
Thank you, Stuart. Can I come finally to Jackie Dunbar? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Convener. How well does the support from the current national agencies reflect the diversity of our learners, including our care experienced young folk and those who have protected characteristics.
Stuart first.
I'm going to throw in this one because we have been dealing with a significant issue with ASN support. And I'm going to flag that one up in particular, that with the additional support needs, what we are seeing is a massive, massive, I think it's 400-500% increase in the number of children who are identified as ASN. And we are seeing almost a 70% drop on ASN staff. That is a complete and utter failure of those children and learners within the school environment and from the support agencies. I would also suggest to you that as well, we know that from social services, as they're cutting back and they're facing financial difficulties, often what happens is that social services will deal primarily with the urgent cases, the priority cases, and school staff and support staff are then left to pick up the pieces. We're not qualified social workers. So I think there is a disconnect between the various agencies, and that is having a direct impact on the workload of not just teachers in the school, the entire school staff, and I would also say as well, the local authority. It's having a huge impact where those agencies are not getting the funding that they need to provide the support, and that's impacting on the school environment. I'll leave it at that for my colleagues.
We'll go back the way we start, Anne, and go that way this time.
Yeah, I mean, Stuart's absolutely highlighted the imperative for additional resourcing in ESN without a doubt, and this committee has obviously just completed its report, which I think is debating in Parliament or being presented in Parliament this afternoon. I mean, huge. We have our campaign Stand Up for Quality Education, which looks at the correlation between workload, violence and aggression and ASN, and with 37% of children across Scotland, with additional support needs, and as Stuart's highlighted, the falling numbers of specialists, that's a real concern for us and one that needs urgent investment. So we can look at reform, we can look at how our resources are being spent, but we absolutely need additional investment for children and young people in that sphere. And that also relates to the support that they receive from the national agencies. So I referred previously to the additional assessment arrangements from the SQA and the advice that's come out, where we've worked collaboratively to try and improve that, to ensure that that children and young people, or young people who are sitting exams, have the appropriate supports in place. So I'm pleased that that has been taken forward recently, and I would like to see that type of engagement continue, because we need to ensure that we are providing the best supports for children and young people in our schools.
I would totally agree with my colleagues that, to say that the stress on ASN numbers and the rise in that, and the reverse amount of support that's getting the resources is making things far more difficult. I'm going to praise the SQA as well for once about the triple A's, the support that they give to young people with ASN characteristics, and also the digital papers that they are supporting young people. So I think there's a lot of good coming out for the SQA in order to help our young people be assessed better. I think Education Scotland also have done a lot to support those with particular characteristics, and I think probably every week I put something out to my members, an update that's come from Education Scotland, whether it's about LGBTQ or whether it's about the recent riots down south and how people felt threatened up here. All that sort of advice is coming from Education Scotland. I think that's worthwhile, and I think they're back on the ball there, and I think that there's a big change there. I think, again, it comes down to resources, and the local authorities and the Scottish Government need more resources. I know we keep saying there's no money, but there is money. There is money. There's a huge budget. It's just how do we prioritise those things within that budget, and that is a political decision which local authorities and the Scottish Government have to make at the end of the day. But I know there's no extra money, and I think we need to say that.
We've heard from the other three panel members around additional support needs, but I'm wondering if Lawrence can maybe focus on the care experienced angle.
Absolutely. I think this is where we need some policy join-up at a national level and a local level. If I think about things like the Promise and so on, I think there's some really good work coming out of the Promise. There's some really good practice locally. Certainly within my area, seeing a huge increase in the number of Promise care experienced young people groups across our school estate, where young people are coming together, under the banner of UNCRC as well to really express their rights as care experienced young people. So I think it's incumbent on all of us to do everything we can to ensure they have a quality of experience. And I do think there's more that we can be doing, more that we can be expecting from the national agencies specifically in relation to care experienced young people. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, that's super. Thank you all for joining us today. And as with our first panel, we did have a lot to get through, and I'm glad we got through all in time, given the little hiccups we had at the beginning. So thanks for your evidence. And this concludes the public part of our meeting. And we will now suspend to allow our witnesses to leave. And the committee will then move into private session to consider its final agenda items. Thanks, everyone. Thank you.